I always kind of lean with star players on primetime games or ESPN TNT games. It usually matters to them a lot more. Plus, the game for the Suns matters big time. They are currently in eighth place in the Western Conference. They are a game back of Dallas for sixth. They're tied with Sacramento, actually, for seventh. But as you know, 7 through 10 play the play-in, whereas 1 through 6, you're in, like, the real playoffs. So the Phoenix Suns have a lot to play for. The Nuggets, I mean, if they want the number one overall seed, they have a lot to play for as well. But I'll take Durant. His season average is, like, just under 27. So the over-under tonight is 25.5. I will absolutely take that. All right, back to our talk on Robert Kraft. This was another interesting question that was brought up yesterday in regards to if they do, in fact, take a quarterback with the third pick, how ready is the team for said quarterback?
Mac Jones was traded this offseason, and what you saw with him over the last 3 years, do you think the team is in a better position now to help a young quarterback going forward with, you know, the offensive coaches that Gerard brought in?
Definitely. I think Alex Van Pelt has had great experience. I don't think the last couple of years how we handle the offense, speaking as a fan, you know, was the kind of approach we wanted. Yeah. Look, one way or another, we know at some point we're going to get a young quarterback who will be gifted. And fortunately, there's a number of them in this draft. And, you know, where we take that position will depend on what comes to us. But I hope our personnel people do a good job in that area, and I really believe we have the coaching to support that.
All right. I mean, so you like the Gerard Mayo, Alex Van Pelt combo more than Bill Belichick, Bill O'Brien?
Now I feel like you're peeing on me and telling me it's lemonade.
Yeah, right, right. Ah, Van Pelt's got a ton of experience. Yeah, nobody wanted him.
He's never called a play.
No. He called under Dick Geron back in 2009.
Yeah, because someone was out sick.
No. So he called plays when Stefanski had COVID in like 2020. Yeah. But his first offensive coordinator gig was back in like 2008-09 for a terrible Bills team. And he called plays, and then Geron got fired. Then I think he didn't last much longer. So he's got a tremendous amount of experience. I mean, that's true. He's been in the league a long time as like a QB coach and things like that. But obviously, Patricia and Judge was a disaster, and it's one of the worst decisions Bill made. But last year, it was Bill Belichick and Bill O'Brien. By all accounts, it was Robert Kraft that insisted on Bill O'Brien. So those two, you feel like that Mayo and Van Pelt are far better for a young quarterback than those two. Like, all right, okay. We shall see. 1 hour down, 3 hours to go on the Rich Keefe Show. Fitzy is going to join us for the final 2 hours of the program starting at 8. Rob Bradford coming up at 7:20. You guys can get in here anytime at 617-779-7937, which the Bruins, Kraft. Also, maybe an update on what Bill Belichick could be doing next season. We'll get to all that coming up next here on WEEI.
20 years ago, a bunch of idiots shocked the world.
For the first time in 86 years.
is live on the free Odyssey app.
Hour number two of the Rich Keefe Show here on WEEI. It is a full tang Wednesday night. On opening day eve, that's right, Red Sox baseball starts tomorrow night. So actually the rest of this week and most of next week, we have a bunch of close to full shows as they open up the season, they being the Red Sox on the West Coast. So Andy Hart will be in tomorrow as we have a like a 3-hour regular show, then the hour pregame, and then a 10-10 first pitch against the Mariners. Rob Bradford's going to join us at 7:20 from the Baseball Isn't Boring podcast. But I'd mention, what is Bill Belichick, who has been very quiet since he mutually parted ways with Robert Kraft and the Patriots, what is he going to be doing next year? I thought maybe he'd be coaching the Dallas Cowboys. Maybe he'd be coaching the New York Jets. Maybe he'd be coaching the Philadelphia Eagles. Nope, not coaching. And so then it turns to TV, and Andrew Marchand for The Athletic wrote an article today, and actually it was mainly about the pursuit of Jason Kelce. Like, everybody wants Jason Kelce, NBC, CBS, Amazon, ESPN, they all want Jason Kelce, and there's talk that Robert Griffin III might be out of the Monday Night Football pregame show, and maybe Jason Kelce goes in there. But in there, he says, quote, while ESPN continues to pursue Bill Belichick, Belichick has told networks he is disinclined to be part of a regular studio show. According to officials briefed on the talks, ESPN could combine with Peyton Manning's Omaha Productions and NFL Films to secure the legendary coach for a broadcasting role. So I just feel if Bill wants to coach again, and I think that he does, I still think he would want to go for the record. He probably, like, if you go back to the press conference that they had when he spoke, didn't answer questions, but when he spoke for a little bit, and then when Robert talked right after, and he was saying how, like, hey, I'll be rooting for Bill except when he's coaching against us. Like, I think in that moment, they both really thought Bill Belichick was going to be a head coach in the NFL somewhere this upcoming season. And hasn't happened, doesn't happen. But if he wants to get back into it, those guys usually aren't great in the media because they come on there, they don't criticize a single player because they're afraid, well, I'm either going to coach that guy next year or coach against them. I'm not going to criticize other coaches because we're in this, like, coach fraternity. So I think Bill could be good on TV, but I think it's in very specific parts. Like, everybody points to, like, well, look at the personality he had at game day. It's like, yeah, he's talking about Army-Navy.
Yeah, for 10 minutes, too.
It was 10 minutes Army-Navy, which is very specific, very niche for Bill Belichick. He's the perfect guy to have on for that. Or when he did the NFL Films, they did their top 100 players of all time. And you're talking about guys that were, like, snappers in the 1940s, and Bill Belichick's like, yeah, he had a good stance, and you're like, well, okay, like, he is a historian of football. So I think that there's probably nobody better that you'd rather talk to. But if you're like, hey, bro, compare Patrick Mahomes and Josh Allen and, like, tell me, like, what's bad about them.
Not only that, be at this place at this time every weekend.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
I don't think he wants that. I'm telling you, even if Bill Belichick wasn't to get a job coaching next season, and if he was done, I don't think he wants to sign up for a regular TV deal.
Probably not. Now, the Manning cast thing, so those guys do, like, a alternate broadcast of Monday Night Football, which I honestly don't watch. Every once in a while, there's, like, I can't stand the Mannings.
He's a Manning hater.
Once I dislike somebody, I dislike them until the day I die. That's how it goes. I never liked those guys. I still don't like those guys. But, you know, they have, like, big-time guests on. So, I mean, like, Bill could be a guest on there, or I wonder if Bill's going to get some sort of recurring role. Like, his buddy Nick Saban is in the media, and he's going to be doing, like, a lot of college football stuff. It is funny. Like, oftentimes, and there are probably a bunch of examples of this, players or coaches who just hate the media immediately join it. Like, the second their career is over, they're like, I'll go do that.
How about a big bag of money?
Yeah, like, all right, sold. So that's sort of the latest on Bill Belichick. Meanwhile, Steve Belichick, we know that he is he spoke today. We'll get to that a little bit later on in the program, but the defensive coordinator at the University of Washington for the upcoming season. All right, back to the phones. We got Rob out in Western Mass. He joins us next. What's going on, Rob?
Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey.
Long-time listener. I've been on the phone with you a couple of times.
Nice.
My my question is, do you really think like Patriots had a better offseason than Tennessee? I mean, they signed Pollard, they lost Derrick Henry. Mm-hmm. They also got Calvin Ridley, which is another big sign. Do you believe in
they also got
Levi, quarterback?
I was going to say, they also got L'Jarius Sneed, the cornerback from the Chiefs, who's really good.
Yes. So what I'm saying is, like, based on what we just saw this offseason, I think Tennessee, whether they have a good quarterback or not, they should be way better than the Patriots. I just feel like they have so much more talent. I mean, I don't know exactly what their offensive line looks like, but, like, I think they're off season. I mean, they signed Mason Rudolph, too, as, like, a backup, so I can't see them having three, but I've looked stuff up if Tannehill's been released, and I don't see anything like that on there.
I think he might have even been a free agent. I think they have just Will Levis, Mason Rudolph, and Malik Willis, I believe, are their quarterbacks for the upcoming season. But I'll tell you what, Rob, like, they made some good signings, but I don't think they're a very good team. I don't think Calvin Ridley went the – and maybe Will Levis will surprise a lot of people, but I just looked this up. We were talking about the Patriots' win total in Vegas for the upcoming season is 4.5, which combined with the Carolina Panthers is the lowest in the league. Tennessee's, even after this free agency, this was updated a day ago, 5.5. So they're not buying in on Tennessee at all. Maybe if Mike Vrabel is still there, but they move on from Vrabel. They bring in a young coach who's never done it before. And, I mean, it's going to come down to how good is Will Levis. Because Tony Pollard's good, but he's also replacing Derrick Henry. The defense is kind of whatever. Well, I mean, Snead's good. He was a guy the Patriots could have gone after. They didn't. Didn't cost a lot draft pick-wise. But they do have Nick Folk. Everybody likes Nick Folk. That guy's going to drill some kicks. But yeah, I don't think the Titans are all that good. I don't think it's like, oh man, he went there because they're going to turn things around. In fact, Houston and Jacksonville, I would say, in that division are both better. I mean, maybe even the Colts. Like, they're not a wagon by any stretch. What do you want to see Bill Belichick do TV next year, Stiz? Or is it almost like, hey, kind of stay out of the spotlight, stay out of any of that, and then just get back into coaching as soon as you can?
No, I'm a sucker for instant gratification.
Yeah, let's see
whether it's a train wreck, whether it's not. Yeah. I mean, yeah, of course. If Bill Belichick was on TV tomorrow night, it's appointment television for me, you know?
Yeah, that is true. Like, we would definitely watch it, and I think I'd be more interested because, like, Gronk and Edelman and those guys, like, immediately got into the media, but it was like, all right. Like, Gronk, every once in a while we would play the stuff that he would say, like, when he would screw up names or whatever, but you're like, all right, that's fine. Then, like, Edelman was on one of those shows that I think might have been on either Showtime or he was on one of those shows. And I'm like, okay. There's so many former Patriots in the media. It's insane. Like, everywhere you turn, there's somebody.
Did you catch the Edelman has his own podcast now. Did you catch Matthew Slater on it, this latest episode?
Oh, yeah. Actually, matter of fact,
it's pretty good.
This was, I believe, got to be a part of Grab Bag last night, but we had so much stuff going on. Do I have that in here? Let's see. Oh, yeah, here's Edelman and Slater. Thank you. Thanks for bringing this up.
February 3rd, 2019, Mercedes-Benz Stadium, Atlanta, Georgia.
High-flying offense.
Every day hustle I wish.
Star-studded defense.
Under pressure.
Yeah.
The old guard versus the new.
Every day hustle I wish.
But this low-scoring affair come down to special teams.
Early in the morning, late up at night.
This is Super Bowl 53.
All I took was.
What'd you think of that, Stiz?
It pumped me up. It pumped me up. So it got me.
Stop, I run through a wall for these guys.
I clicked on it today and watched it. Some interesting things said from those guys. About the dynasty, about Wes Welker in particular.
Yeah, so Edelman basically called Wes Welker a liar. So he's just lying about stuff, lying about Aaron Hernandez. So now we have a feud between the great slot receivers of our time. I don't know about that.
He said, don't lie, Wes. I know you just don't like Bill. Keep it a buck.
Oh, man. Not good. Not good between those guys once they start getting after each other a little bit. But it seems like every Patriot player either has a podcast, has a TV show that they're on, both. But Bill would be so different. Bill would be really different. I don't know if it would be like appointment viewing all season. Like if he had one of these studio jobs, especially the studio jobs are insane. I don't know how many of you still watch the NFL pregame shows. I usually just jump in at 1 o'clock. So I'm like, all right, I'm going to be watching football all day. I can't start at 12 with a 10-person round table of former players and coaches. So I don't really watch a lot of the pregame shows anymore. But you're one of like 20 people on a show. So it's like you don't even really say that much.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to see Bill oversaturated.
Yeah, no, that's it. Well, by according to that story in The Athletic, it doesn't sound like Bill wants to do that either. So maybe they can do something creative with him, and maybe he does do something a la the Manning cast. I know some people are saying like he and Saban could do one. And you, I mean, talk about like deep dive coaching stuff. And maybe if they just keep it strictly to X's and O's and they don't put themselves in a spot where they have to critique players as much. Because like that's one thing that Peyton Manning has done, right? Like we've played certain clips where he'll just call out a quarterback. Because like what does he care? Like he's not going back in the game. He doesn't care if he hurts that guy's feelings. That's why Charles Barkley's the best. Charles Barkley says whatever's on his mind with the NBA guys. And some of them get really pissed and sensitive about it. But he and Shaq just sit there and rip guys. And it's great. Bill wouldn't do that. But there still probably is a way to use him. I mean, nobody knows more about football than Belichick, so you might as well tap into that if you can. All right, Rob Bradford from the Baseball Isn't Boring podcast is going to join us here coming up as the Boston Red Sox open up the 2024 season tomorrow against the Seattle Mariners. We just found out last night on this very show that Jordan Montgomery has decided to sign with the Arizona Diamondbacks. 2 years, $50 million with an opt-out after the first year. So I'll ask Bradfo what the hell happened there. Were the Red Sox even close? And the outlook for this season, Stiz is positive on them, though. Don't forget that. Stiz likes the over.
Smashing the over. 78, smashing the over.
All right, very good. All right, it's the Rich Keefe Show here, WEEI. Right now here is Stiz with What's Trending.
Your home of the Sox. Now, here's What's Trending on WEEI.
All right, let's get you caught up with what's trending right now on WEEI and WEEI.com. After beating the Panthers 4-3 last night, the Bruins will remain on the road. They are in Tampa Bay tonight, getting ready to take on the Lightning. Tampa Bay's been on a roll during the second half of their season. They've gone 28-2 in their last 30 games to seize control of the first wild card spot in the Eastern Conference. Linus Ullmark will be in the net for your Boston Bruins. Celtics have the night off tonight. Their road trip continues tomorrow night as they remain in Atlanta to take on the Hawks. The Hawks managed to crawl back from a 30-point deficit, beating the Celtics 120-118 on Monday night. Celtics hope to get some get back tomorrow night at the State Farm Arena. Tip-off at 7:30. Keith just mentioned it earlier, but the Jordan Montgomery sweepstakes now over, as it was reported that the left-handed pitcher has agreed to a free agent deal with the Arizona Diamondbacks pending a physical. However, according to Jeff Passan, the Sox have acquired right-hander Naoyuki Uesawa from the Rays. According to reports, the right-hander triggered an assignment clause, and the Rays were close to making a trade for him. The Rays will receive cash considerations for Uesawa. I'm Stiz. That's what's trending now on WEEI and WEEI.com. More Rich Keefe Show, including the host of the Baseball Isn't Boring podcast, Rob Bradford. Coming up, go nowhere.
WEEI, WEEI, New England Sports Original.
This is Ty Law, Pro Football Hall of Famer. Aviva Trattoria serves beloved Italian classics and is the perfect place to get together with family and friends. Enjoy fresh-made bolognese, marsala, ricotta, and fries.
at a Skechers store, Skechers.com, or wherever stylish footwear is sold.
Remember, you can listen to WEEI on your smart speaker.
Just say, play 93.7 WEEI.
Now, more of the Rich Keefe Show on WEEI.
Allow me to reintroduce myself. My name is Ho, H to the O-V. I used to move snowflakes by the O-T. I guess even
back here on the Rich Keefe Show, WEEI, the night before the Red Sox opener, taking on the Seattle Mariners out in Seattle tomorrow night. Of course, you can hear all the games right here on WEEI. And to help us break it all down, we turn to the Harbor One Hotline, where Rob Bradford of the Baseball Isn't Boring podcast joins us. Bradford, how are you, sir?
Let's go. I'm in Seattle, Rich.
Holy smokes.
Glorious.
So it's still daylight out there. I don't understand how time zones work, but I believe you still have, you haven't even had your supper yet.
I mean, it was almost worth that 6-hour plane ride to see the daylight at this time of night. It's so crazy.
Brutal.
It's kooky.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you, last night on the program, we found out that Jordan Montgomery signed with the Arizona Diamondbacks and 2 years, $50 million. And I'm not shocked. Like, after the Blake Snell contract, I'm like, all right, well, Jordan Montgomery's not going to do better than that. And he didn't. Any idea if the Red Sox were close? Were they still talking to him? Were they interested? Because that doesn't seem like a crazy contract at all to hand out.
No, I mean, I haven't get particulars in terms of how much they were in on him at the end. I know that throughout baseball, you know, whether it was agents or whether it was reporters or whatever it was, I think most people thought that it was going to land with the Red Sox, honestly. And I think we were all sort of skeptical about it. But if you said that this guy was going to get a 1-year deal with an option for a second with an opt out, like, oh, okay, great. I mean, we were talking about, oh, can you imagine if it drops to 4 years? Well, it did, and then it kept on going. And what's remarkable, you talk about the Boers clients, this one by far, I thought, was the biggest hit for them because, you know, I know that they were asking for number one starter money throughout the majority of the offseason. You know, you're talking about between $150 and $200 million, and this is where you land. You know, that's a tough pill to swallow. So, yeah, in terms of the Red Sox, I wrote this today. I mean, I think it just came down to probably like, hey, you know what? You know, at this point, we're good with what we have. And, you know, you might not think it's good enough, but we think it's good enough. And investing in Jordan Montgomery, it wasn't going to be worth it. And I know this, too. It's like, you know, you have a guy like Mike Clevenger sitting there who had a very good second half, who a lot of people think could be slid into the back of a rotation to be really, really good for you, sort of a proven guy. You know what you're going to get. And they never made an offer to him. And they still haven't made an offer to him. Same with Lorenzen. So I just think that they sort of say, okay, you know what? We're going to dig on this guy and go from there.
Is Scott Boras still looked at?
You don't sound excited.
No, I mean, I'm not. Like, I just feel like the years went down so low. And the average annual, like, yeah, like in a vacuum, is he a $25 million pitcher? Maybe not. But when he's a free agent and he's one of the five best available in the offseason, then, yeah, you got to overpay a little bit. But you're only overpaying for a year, maybe two.
Right.
You're not committed to him long term. As for Boras, is he still like the Bob Sugar of Major League Baseball, or is he losing some of that luster? Yeah, yeah, it's a good reference.
Try stealing my client. Go ahead. I think that this offseason hasn't gone as he planned. There's no doubt about it. But he has so much benefit of the doubt, I think, in the world of baseball because of all the money that he's made so many guys. And you know, my guess is that, you know, why they probably didn't read this market right, they'll probably read the next market correctly. So, yeah, I mean, I think that's the narrative right now, that this guy, maybe he doesn't have his fastball anymore. But still, I think, I mean, I've seen top prospects in the last month switch agencies to Boras already.
Okay.
They keep going. I mean, if you go into a clubhouse and you say, well, who's the best guy to make you money, most of the guys are going to say Scott Boras. So, you know, I don't think this is a huge hit for them. I think for the guys involved, it was probably a huge hit for them. But still, I mean, all of them are positioned in a way, this is what you can say for Boris, all of them positioned in a way where next year or the year after, they can still make a lot of money for themselves.
Is there anything fishy to you about the free agents this year? There were very, very few that signed really long-term deals. You obviously have Yamamoto and Ohtani, and I almost put them in like a separate category altogether. And then Aaron Nola signed, he re-signed a 7-year deal with the Phillies, but that's his own team. They wanted him. Everybody else, I think, was like 5 years or less, which I don't remember the last time that happened in baseball. I feel like usually you get some of these crazy Corey Seager, Marcus Simeon, Xander Bogaerts, like wild contracts.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that, you know, obviously everyone jumps to the collusion stuff, but yeah. I think one of the things that you have to sort of look at, and I do believe this, is that the way that baseball has changed is that these teams and these front offices think that they can fix guys. They can take a guy and they can make him into a guy that's just as good as the guy that you would have to pay a ton of money to. So in other words, the Red Sox were in on Jordan Hicks, right? Jordan Hicks was this relief pitcher who threw 100, you know, up and down. But anyway, so he ends up signing. He sends a 4-year deal with the Giants, I think, for like $40 million. The Red Sox wanted to do sort of the same thing with him, make him a starter. And I think that when you ask, like, who were the Red Sox in on, what was their approach? They looked at that and said, well, we can take this guy, pay him less money, and then get a much, much bigger return because we can tweak this or tweak that. And I think that's the way that these teams are going, and that's why I think you're not seeing the Dombrowski go shock and awe. We're going to overpay by $40 million for David Price anymore.
What do you think of Alex Cora's future on the team? I know it's been much, much discussed. He's in the last year of his contract. I know he was on with Jones and Mego. In fact, he'll be on all year long on the Jones and Mego program. Alex Cora will join them, and he wouldn't really answer it. He was like, everybody knows the situation, but it was an interesting follow-up from Jones. He was like, have they approached you about an extension? And he said, no. So what do you make of Alex Cora's future here in Boston?
Well, I think that if you listen to his answer, it says, yeah, he says, no, you know, we haven't talked. But then he goes on and he just says it very, very quickly. And I'm going to paraphrase, but it's something to the effect of, and, you know, and I don't know, you know, and I haven't talked to them. So it was, if you listen to it, it was clear of, yeah, you know, I understand why they're not talking to me, but they also have to understand why I might not be talking to them. You know, I'm not saying that he came out directly and said that, but there is that mindset with you know, he's in a great place and he feels good about things and he feels good about his future, and he makes little references to, I don't know if I'm going to do this or I'm going to do that, I'm going to do this. But if you do go back and listen to that answer, he says it very, very quick. He's not. This isn't just like, oh, I'm sitting by the phone hoping they call.
Yeah.
At least that's the way he's positioned, you know, so – you know, I think that's sort of going to be his approach. Yeah, I mean, and you know, at the end of the day, Rich, too, I think the council contract, you know, that has an effect on a lot of managers where they said, oh, yeah, you know what? I'll go to free agency because I'll make a ton of money because Greg Council did.
Yeah, no, for sure. But that's an interesting one. And it always is when you have like a GM or president or chief baseball officer, whatever the title happens to be, when they inherit a manager, like Dave Dombrowski inherited John Farrell, and you're like, I wonder how long this is going to go. And it's just sort of a weird dynamic. And I don't know how empowered Craig Breslow is when it comes to the manager, but the fact that they didn't sign him an extension, he's going into a lame duck year, makes me believe that, all right, maybe they are giving Breslow a good amount of power.
But I don't buy too much into they're not talking to him. They didn't sign him an extension, that this is how it's going to be. Like, no, I mean, I think that it's like Breslow still doesn't have a GM. And the reason he doesn't have a GM is because he wants to wait it out to figure out who the best fit for that job is. I think it's the same thing. I don't think he doesn't not like – I don't think he has anything against Cora. Mm. I don't think he's saying, oh, man, he's not the guy. He's a bad manager, whatever. I think he's going to let it play out a little bit. And that's understandable. Now, the challenge here is going to be when you get halfway through the year – and this conversation starts amping up one way or the other, that's where it gets uncomfortable. Whether it's managers or whether it's players. I mean, I remember Tito Francona, you know, back in 2011, through all that chaos, that was part of the chaos.
Mm-hmm.
They, you know, Jim Leland had signed an extension, I think, in August, and they're letting Francona sit there. I think he had his contract was up. They had options. They weren't picking up his options. And I remember talking to him the last day of the season about it.
Yeah.
So these guys can talk about mindsets, and they're all good. It's human nature to be to wonder what's going on. So that's what I'm going to keep an eye on as the season goes on.
Talking to Rob Bradford, Baseball Isn't Boring podcast. He's out in Seattle. That is where the Red Sox will open the season. Four-game series against the Mariners. One guy that I feel like has completely flown under the radar, maybe not in spring training. You can speak to it differently. But at least up here, the names we always mention, one that gets left out is one of the higher-paid guys on the team, and that's Trevor Story. What kind of season are you expecting? He's almost like a forgotten guy up here because he's been hurt so much, and then it's like you're mad at the ownership. They signed Devers. There's a couple other guys that are more exciting. So where do you come down on the type of season Story could have?
No, I'm glad you brought him up because that's actually like the thing I wrote for writing for tomorrow is based on Trevor Story. And Cora, in his interview today with Mego and Jones, said something effective. You know, it all starts with Story. It all, like, he basically making it seem like he was the most important player on this team. And I find it really interesting because he, to me, is a microcosm of this whole deal where he can be a star, he can be an all-star, he can be a foundation guy, but he hasn't been.
Yeah.
And so you have to go out and prove – they have to find these guys, Rich. I mean, they have to start finding all-stars. They can't have one all-star at the all-star game. And I do believe this. I've said this a couple times. I do believe Trevor Story will be at the all-star game this year. Like, the guy that I've seen play in Fort Myers is really, really good. And we haven't seen the Trevor Story, the shortstop that everyone is raving about in 2019. He's a really good shortstop. I've seen it down in Fort Myers, and I think he ended up with like 1,100 OPS for a spring. Not that that matters.
Yeah, yeah.
Hitting .380, but still, like you see the guy, I'm like, okay, I can see why they thought this guy was actually a really, really good player, because up until now we haven't seen that. His OPS collectively with the Red Sox has been under 700.
Yeah. Two other guys that could be all-stars, I guess, or at least should be in that mix, is Casas and Devers. But I'm curious, do you think both guys will stay at their current position in the field? Because there were certainly times last year where you're like, maybe not.
Yeah, I mean, they don't really have a lot of options.
No.
I mean, this year anyway. I don't think you make that sort of switch mid-year unless you have to. And Devers has been good this spring, but he was good last spring defensively. I think it gets in his head. He was good in April last year defensively, and then it fell apart. So, you know, Casas, I think, is getting progressively better at defensively. So, you know, this is the thing, Rich, right? They go in, we got to be better defensively. We got to have a better – our starters have to go deeper. You know, well, okay, you know, you got to go out and prove it. I do think by taking Yoshida out, you are going to be better defensively. O'Neill's much better than he is. Sadon Rafaela is much better in center field. So, yeah, I get that. But to your point, you need Devers to be good. You need Casas to be good. You need – and by the way, you don't have a good defensive second baseman now either. So, yeah, so it's a work in progress. The one guy that I actually – and you can – you know, whatever futures you want to put on this. I know that Stiz is pounding the over.
He is. Right? He's all about the over now. He's got talked into this team. Yeah.
I wanted to ask Bradford what he thought about that.
I don't know if you can – I don't know if this is something that's like a prop or not, but I just found this out. I didn't know it. I wish I did. So the record for most consecutive opening days, hitting a home run on opening day, is four in a row. And there's one active player who has hit the home runs in his last four opening days, and that is Tyler O'Neill.
If Tyler O'Neill
hits a home run, if he hits a home run tomorrow, he will hold a major league record for most, which I didn't realize, but
good.
I do think this. He's one of my picks to click this year. I think Tyler O'Neill is going to have a good year. I do.
I was looking at over. We're going to go through some over unders in a little bit, but Tyler O'Neill's home run total. Could you see what it is? The Vegas over under.
No, what is it?
It's 21.5. It seems high to me.
Really?
I know you got. He's your pick to click. Is he going to click that much? That seems like a lot.
I mean, you have to go back to it. It all goes back to that 2021 season, where he finished eighth in MVP voting.
Right.
I think he had 32 home runs, and it's over 900 OPS. So they're like, well, if he stays healthy, he's going to hit home runs, because also, I don't know if you know this.
Yeah, 34.
They don't have enough weight. They don't have enough weights in the weight room for him to bench.
Yeah, he's got quite a physique, I've heard. Yeah. That's good.
Yeah. That might have been my favorite thing of all spring training, when Tyler O'Neill said, I said, how much do you max out at? Because, you know, that's what we all
Sure. Great question. That's how I usually,
You know, it's like the weight belt and the lifting gloves and the big jug of water.
All of it.
And I said, and he's like, well, they don't have, the weights don't go up high enough here. So they only have 125. I need 150. I'm like, again, the Red Sox cheaping out. They can't even have weights big enough for Tyler O'Neill to max out.
Even Robert Kraft's embarrassed about how bad their weight room is. Stiz actually pulled the clip from Alex Cora. So let's play this. This is what we were gonna read between the lines, or just listen closely, I should say. Alex Cora about his future.
It sounds like you want to. Have they approached you about staying?
No, we haven't talked about it. And I respect that. And from my end, you know, it's the same thing.
All right.
There you go.
So we haven't talked about it. All right.
No.
But on his end, it's the same thing. Yeah.
From my end, it's the same thing.
Yeah.
Like you said, we haven't talked about it. From my end, it's the same thing.
I am also not interested in the conversation. Yeah.
Well, they haven't called me, but you know what? I haven't called them either.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Fair. Are you surprised that Kenley Jansen didn't get traded?
No, because he wasn't healthy. I mean, he had the lat thing, and then he had the back thing, and then all of a sudden, he squeezed in five appearances at the end. So it wasn't the timing didn't add up, but. Was I surprised that in the offseason, like he said, he's like, there was a time in the offseason, I said, what are the odds that you're going to get on the plane to Fort Myers? He thought 60-40, 60 that he wasn't going to get on the plane. So it was on his radar, absolutely. But when you start spring training and you're hurt, you're not throwing, and then the first time out, you're not good, and then you have a back issue, that isn't getting max value. Mm-hmm. So to me, it didn't make sense anyway. Because you get this trade deadline, A, if you're in it, you don't want to be chasing the closer. And B, if you're not in it, you're going to get twice the value at the trade deadline.
Right.
So, anyway, Kenley's still here. I can confirm Kenley's still here.
Who do you are you taking the over like Stiz at, was it 78.5? Is that the last one you saw, Stiz?
Yeah.
Are you taking the over?
I told Megan and Jones yesterday, 80.
All right,
I'll put it this way. I'm with Stiz, and since Stiz, now that he's a big shot of the executive producer of the Red Sox baseball as well, he's been seduced by listening to all the spring training broadcasts and all these performances. But you know, I come away and I try not to be, but I'll tell you that I think the camp went pretty well for them. But everything has to break right. Everything has to break right in order for them to actually have a legit shot here. And that's a big, Rich. You know baseball.
I've been in the booth. You know, I've done some games, so I get it.
You know how it is. I know that as a broadcaster,
right.
You try not to take sides. You just call the action that's right in front of
that's
you.
That's it.
But it's a dangerous, to come back to the Montgomery thing, it's a dangerous game. When you go in and you say, every one of these guys is going to be better, and that's how we're going to be good. And I hate to keep coming back to the 2015 five aces, but that's the lesson that should be learned.
Right. That's like with every single team. Somewhere. Like if everybody has a career year, it's baseball. They're all pros. Pick a team. If they all have career years, I bet that team makes the playoffs. But it just doesn't happen. It doesn't happen that way. Who do you think wins the American League East? I think it seems like it could be Baltimore the favorite, but then you never know. And the Yankees, if their duo really takes off, who do you like in the division?
I like Toronto. I think the Justin Turner signing was a sneaky one of the best signings of the offseason for them. They already had a ton of talent. And by the way, speaking of betting, I just did a podcast with our old friend Jonathan Papelbon.
Yes.
And here's some betting advice. He said he's not betting the Dodgers to win a game in the entire month of April because of all the chaos with Otani.
Smart. Yeah, so, that'll be good. Good investment.
Smart. Yeah. There you go.
I did see the guys from Pardon My Take tweeted out that they're going to bet the run line against the A's all season and see how that goes.
Oh, that's not interesting.
It's not a bad one. I remember trying to do that last year during the Bet du Jour, and it hit a few times, but then they would randomly win or they would randomly lose by one, and you're like, okay, I'm back out now. But I think if you stay committed to it, I feel like that has to be profitable.
I feel like, can you just, because we start tomorrow, pregame show's tomorrow.
That's right, 9:10. Oh, yes. You better believe it. Right. Locked in, 9:10 pregame.
Yep. So let's just commit to that. Instead of like just randomly, let's commit to that.
The A's.
Let's commit to the
A's.
Yep. Yeah, the A's. Yep. Let's commit to that.
Mm-hmm.
You're probably going to be right. Mm-hmm. And let's be honest. You get to that segment. I know how that works, Rich.
Yep.
You just want to get through it. Like, you don't have to want to look anything up.
Not me, Bradfo. I am very committed. You're going to get a good hour pregame before every single game. Well, right, Stiz? We swear to that.
Come on. Full throttle.
Locked in. And we got the new feature, the Bradfo feature, not to spoil the whole pregame show. Monday, Wednesday, Friday, there's a new little something
here. Yeah, McFarland Energy. Yeah, sponsored. The baseball isn't boring. Get this, Stiz. Ready? Wait for it. The 2-minute grill.
Yes.
Where I grill somebody for 2, maybe 3 minutes.
Sure.
So, yeah, I already got the first one out of the way. Spoiler alert, Jaron Duran's talking about his first ever opening day. It's going to be spicy.
I like that. Yeah. Oh, have you had the fried grasshoppers out there in Seattle? What? That's one of the. So a lot of ballparks have like a unique little piece of flair. No, Stiz was saying what? So each ballpark has like a different kind of thing, and that they're known for fried grasshoppers. You can get them at the concession stand.
Yeah, no. So I haven't. Last time I was here for the All-Star game last year. My memories of Seattle, the ballpark, was not the ballpark, but I got one of those scooters. I don't know if you're a big scooter guy.
I'm not.
You go to a city, say, hey.
No.
Those things are awesome.
It really activates the core, let me tell you.
Okay, all right.
Especially when you get lost in Seattle and do it for, no lie, 2 hours and go 11 miles on it.
You have to stop and charge that thing or like load it with gas?
No,
how did you, 11
no,
miles.
Not going. Yeah. It was like $50 for the scooter. I got totally lost, but that was beautiful. And the other one was I was walking through the concourse and Theo Epstein's walking the other way and say, let me introduce you to Eddie. I'm like, oh, that Eddie. Eddie Vedder. Yeah. So bucket.
Well, Eddie Vedder's walking around Seattle. Why not?
Just walking
makes sense. That's how I envision
like cliche,
it.
Right?
Yeah, right.
Well, I'm going to be very upset if we don't get a Twitter video of Bradfo eating
a grasshopper.
Grasshopper. Yeah.
I feel like that's happening.
Listen. I'll anything for the company, Sid. You know that.
Slap on a baseball isn't boring shirt. Yeah, eat a cricket. You're good to go.
Bradfo isn't boring.
All right. Well, it is the Baseball Isn't Boring podcast. Check it out on the Odyssey app, wherever you get your podcast. Bradfo, thanks for the time tonight, and I'm sure we'll be talking to you a lot throughout the season.
Yeah, let's go. Yay for baseball. And I look forward to talking with you guys. You guys are the best.
All right. Thank you. Very good. Appreciate that. And that's right. Baseball season is upon us. A March opener, although a lot of these openers seem like they've been in March recently. But out in Seattle, 4-game series. You can listen to all of it here on WEEI. So it's a 10:10 first pitch tomorrow, then a 9:40 first pitch on Friday. But every pregame show will take place exactly 1 hour prior to first pitch. I got a whole list of over-unders for player props, home runs, RBI, that kind of thing for the Red Sox. We'll pick through some of those, a couple of pitcher props in there as well. And then Fitzy's going to join us at 8 o'clock sharp. So go nowhere. It's the Rich Keefe Show here on WEEI.
Rubenstein Law Studios, 1-800-BOS-LEGAL. This is WEEI. subscribe to The Rich Keefe Show on the Odyssey app or wherever you find your podcasts.
Now, more of The Rich Keefe Show
on WEEI.
Back here on The Rich Keefe Show, WEEI. Fitzy's going to join us at 8 o'clock. You can join us anytime now through 10 at 617-779-7937. We're on Twitter and Instagram at Rich Keefe Show. And you can also watch the program on Twitch. Just go to twitch.tv/BostonWEEI. Get all the shows from 6A all the way up until 10P. And we just had Rob Bradford on talking Red Sox as they open up the season tomorrow against the Mariners, a four-game series with Seattle to get the season going. And if you're into betting, and I know a lot of you are, Stiz is already in on the over for the win total. I got a whole bunch of regular season player props. Rafael Devers, I'm telling you, if he hits his over, you're going to look at him and be like, all right, this guy had a good season. And, you know, they paid him a ton of money. I don't think he's a top-tier player, not to steal from Tier Tuesday. I don't think he is, you know, he's never been a top 10 MVP candidate, which I think is kind of damning, right? Like, you can have a good year. Like, Pedroia won an MVP. Euclid got a bunch of MVP votes in a couple of years, let alone guys like Ortiz and Manny and Mookie Betts. But Devers hasn't been there yet. But I think he really needs to be. And if you look at what Vegas thinks he's going to do this year, they got him at 33.5 home runs and 100.5 RBI. And if he goes 33-100 or 34-100, now I know it's also about OPS and like everything else that he does, but you have those kind of power numbers somewhere in the middle of the lineup, hitting second in the lineup, and you have that kind of season. They're like, all right, that's what they need to get out of Devers. That's a guy that, you know, there's no excuses for him. He signed the massive contract. He agreed to stay here. So, yeah, the surrounding cast is kind of falling apart. But he needs to, you know, his best. Last year, he was right on the nose, 33-100. And there were times where he looked great, looked like he was carrying the offense, and the other times he kind of disappeared. His best season, 2021, he had 38 homers and 113 RBI. 2019, he went 32. So if you look at it this way, every other year he's been a 30 home run guy. That means this year he would not be.
Yeah.
Oh, if you're into the patterns,
I've seen him whack some bombs during spring training this year. That's true. I will say
the guy I'm way more excited about is going to be for sure Tristan Casas, and his over under for homers is 27.5. That I would hit. I would take that. I think he's more likely to hit 30 home runs even than Devers. So I'd take Casas over 27.5. He's also at 80.5 RBI. I'd probably take the over on both of those. Masataka Yoshida's over-under for homers is 16.5. He had a solid rookie year. Remember, there was a time where he was the favorite to be rookie of the year, and then he really kind of fell out of that. He ended the year with 15 home runs. I don't really look at him as like a big power guy, and you could make the argument both ways. You could say, well, it's his second year in the majors. He's going to be more comfortable. Also, every pitcher in the majors now has the book out on him. So we've seen guys have great like second seasons. We've got other guys where the league kind of catches up to him. I think even if he has a good year and he's just DHing, or at least primarily he's just going to be the DH, so that's a good sign. We can just focus on that. He's not a very good defensive left fielder. His over-under at 16.5, I'd probably still take the under. I think he's more of an average guy. More of like a singles kind of slap hitter. So that's what I would say for him. Trevor Story's over-under for home runs is 20.5. And he had back-to-back 30 home run seasons in Colorado. Of course, his home road split's kind of significant. He's much better in Coors Field than he was elsewhere. And then he's just been hurt all the time here. He's a big swing guy for this team. I know the expectations are low. Trust me, I think they're going to be in last place again as well, like most of you. But Story has at least the ability to have a big power type season, and I'm not expecting it, but if he does, that doesn't the lineup look a lot different? He had a 37 home run season in 18, a 35 home run season in 19, and then since then it's been, he did not have a great contract year. He had 24 home runs in 2021, and then he has less than 20 home runs in two seasons with the Sox, but he's only played 137 games. So if you do that, you kind of play that out. If he actually is healthy this year, plays 150 games, that's kind of right on that pace, right around like a 20 home run season. But if it's a lot better than that, well, then maybe the Red Sox will score a bunch of runs. Although runs weren't really the problem last year. It was the pitching. And you look at some of the pitching numbers. They have a Brian Bayo win total at 10.5. I mean, I would probably take the over if he's going to be playing all year long. Not that wins are the most important stat for a pitcher, right? Like, you know, they can have the bullpen blow games for him or whatever, but I would say over on that. And then Kenley Jansen's save total is 30.5. And the reason why I take the over is because I think he starts the season with the team, then he gets traded to like a powerhouse, and then saves a bunch of games after that.
Ah.
Yeah. So, but still, if you're, it's a bet's a bet, and you can get that win there. So, there's a look at some of the over-unders for the Red Sox in the upcoming season, which gets going tomorrow night against Seattle.
I'd like to know what Ohtani is feeling about all this, and then I'll make my bets.
Yeah, what is he looking
what's
at?
He looking at?
What are the ones that jump out to him? Yeah, that's a good point. It seems like there's a guy in every sport now that you can point to and be like, what does Kayshawn Booty think? Yeah, what did Calvin Ridley think? What did Jonte Porter think?
It's getting ugly.
It is. It's insane. We will welcome Fitzy in for the final 2 hours of the program. You can jump in as well at 617-779-7937. It's the Rich Keefe Show here on WEEI.
WEEI.
I love EEI, man.
WEEI.
WEEI. New England's
sports original.
Hey, basketball fans, get in on the tournament action on the BetMGM Sportsbook app today. With BetMGM, you can discover same-game parlays, live bets, special boosts and tokens, and so much more for March matchups. Don't miss a single shot with the king of sportsbooks. BetMGM and GameSense remind you to play responsibly. Hope is here. Call 1-800-327-5050 or visit gamblinghelplinema.org. Must be 21 plus, Massachusetts only, in partnership with MGM Springfield. Play it smart from the start. Live chat at gamesensema.com.
Paid for by National Tax Advisory Services. Attention anyone that owes money to the IRS. The IRS has restarted aggressive enforcement actions against taxpayers who owe back taxes that were temporarily suspended for COVID. If you owe $10,000 or more, you must hear this because now is the time to clear your IRS tax debt. A special toll-free number has been established so you can stop penalty fees, avoid liens, and other hostile measures by the IRS. Call Tax Relief Helpers right now at 800-804-4894 and get the maximum protection afforded by law.
I got behind on my taxes and owed $48,000. I didn't know what to do. I called and they got my bill lowered to just $3,500.
I owed $87,000 in taxes and it was scary. I got the amount I owed down to just $3,500. I saved $83,500.
If you owe money to the IRS, don't wait another day. Call 800-804-4894 right now before the IRS enforces liens, levies, or other aggressive measures. The call and consult are absolutely free. Call now. Call 800-804-4894. 800-804-4894. 800-804-4894.
I'll tell you what's not boring. Good air conditioning. Hey, it's Bradfo. Join me talking baseball every Tuesday at 4:30 with Jones and Mago, courtesy of McFarland Energy, the HVAC experts from Greater Boston to the Cape at McFarlandEnergy.com.
33 great years.
Hi, Kimberly Dare from Commonwealth Chevrolet, and it's our 33rd year in business. Wow. And we want it to be our best year yet for us and especially you.
We've got plenty of Chevys in stock and on the way. Crossovers, SUVs, Silverados, and used vehicles too. And we're celebrating 33 years with our best prices ever.
We shop the competition daily, like we always have, to guarantee you our best price possible every day.
Our best price possible on every Chevy in stock every day.
We want this to be our best year yet. Especially for you.
Commonwealth Chevrolet, located right off Route 495, exit 103A in Lawrence.
For your best Chevy deal, find us fast at shopuslast.com.
We're celebrating 33 years with our best prices ever.
It's our 33rd year in business. Wow.
Hi, Charlie Deere, and thanks for 33 great years, and this will be our best yet.
33 great years, and the best is yet to come. Shop.
Sir?
Rich, I am happy to report that on my pro day, I was able to jump vertically 45 inches, run a 4.240, and I threw it into a 20-mile-an-hour crosswind 95 yards.
But what does your elbow look like?
Oh.
That's where I want to start with you. So the LSU Pro Day, one that certainly the Patriots were there for, everybody with top picks, not just Jaden Daniels, but Malik Nabers, both likely going to be top 5-6 picks. Brian Thomas, like, you have a bunch of first-round picks from LSU. But the thing that everybody's talking about right now is a photo that Ian Rapoport tweeted out, and he just took any photo, I guess, and he was like, hey, immediately following his pro day, LSU QB and potential top 3 pick Jaden Daniels scheduled to meet with the hashtag Patriots, hashtag Commanders, hashtag Giants, hashtag Vikings, hashtag Broncos, and hashtag Raiders.
And you also left out hashtag Beetlejuice Beetlejuice prosthetics crew.
And then a photo of Jaden Daniels throwing a football, and his elbow looks insane. What are we looking at here?
So I immediately went to do the same thing everyone else who was following the pro day throw days today as ravenously as all of us were. And I looked up, like, is this like AI? Like, did Rap Sheet get hacked? Did he accidentally grab the wrong photo? And then there were all of these random, because you know you got to love when the IG and Twitter doctors, the social media doctors, sports doctors swoop in.
They're on it.
And there were all these guys, especially this one doctor, coming in talking about this bizarre form of a bursa sac that can form on.
You're talking about Jesse Morse, MD?
Jesse Morse. I used to watch that show all the time on NBC.
Dr. Jesse Morse stepped in and said, it looks like a olecranon bursitis of his right throwing elbow. And it's an inflammation of the bursa, which is a sac that is usually empty. And there and is there to protect the bone underneath.
Is he hurt
or is he not? Like, I don't know what the hell's going on.
All right, so that makes me wonder, like, okay, if you have this bizarre bursa sac thing that protects the bone underneath, how did it instantly not turn into, hey, so is his elbow going to come flying off, or is he going to need some sort of bizarre, like, surgery? I know Brady had a bursa sac thing at one point. I remember the first time I ever saw one.
Yeah.
I think because of course we always cross-pollinate pop culture with sports as often as possible. Mm-hmm. I think in the movie Heat, Val Kilmer actually had one, and it was like very
really?
I remember seeing it like in one scene late in the movie, and it was very unsettling.
I'm just like looking it up because I remember it like going. I remember hearing it only really with football, and it looks like Peyton Manning might have had a bursa sac injury. Matt Schaub, friend of the show, had one. Patrick Willis, maybe
friend of the show.
No, Matt Schaub was on hashtag Dork because I famously asked him who his favorite superhero was, and he said, "I don't have one." I was like, "All right." I go, "What about supervillain?" He goes, "I don't have one of those either." I was like, all right.
You know what, actually? Why don't you go throw another pick six?
I'll talk to you later, Matt. Thanks for your time. Just say Superman or Batman like the last 20 guys that I interviewed, but that's fine. But nobody's saying anything that he's heard. And so actually, before I even saw the Ian Rapoport tweet, which was the first one, I saw all these people posting about it and talking about it. And so the way my head works is like, all right, so somebody photoshopped it. I thought it was fake at first because it looks so weird. So if you haven't seen it, you can just give a quick bing to Jaden Daniels' elbow, and it looks like the bottom part of his arm like goes longer, like the elbow goes out, and then the forearm kind of connects to like a different piece. It's very strange looking.
Yeah, it does literally look like there's this bone extension to his arm. Like, it looks like a holster or something like that. Like one of those slide, it's like a slide pistol for his elbow or something that comes out of it. It's like, it looks like there's an extra bone, or like his elbow is like extended.
It's crazy. It's
can't, is it really real? Has anyone been able to verify this?
Yeah, you know what? And then I was looking up something else where they were showing other images of Jaden Daniels, and there was one game where he had like tape on his elbow. One game, I think he had a sleeve, and there was one game where it looked a little like that, but maybe not quite as exaggerated as this picture does. But yeah, like it's a legit a weird elbow.
Like, it's
a weird elbow. This is the kind of crap. There's always something weird around the draft time, right, where you find out about some guy's off the field stuff that comes out of nowhere. Remember the Laramie Tunsil? He was smoking weed with a gas mask, and
well,
like,
that was only really, but that was released by a jealous family member, like
right.
an hour before the draft, which right caused his draft stock to absolutely Dip. Plummet.
Yeah, he went. He still went in the first round, but they thought he could be like a top three pick, and he sank.
Okay, Rich, I just went to the Google machine.
Okay.
I typed in Jaden Daniels elbow.
Here we go.
Top stories.
What do we got?
New York Post. Bizarre photo of Jaden Daniels' elbow is breaking the internet.
It is.
The Daily Caller headline. What the hell is going on with Jaden Daniels' elbow?
Seriously. I want to know. I want to know what's going on. All it's been, though, is just people being like, oh, that's weird. That's, but there's no team or, like, I don't know, real doctor that has said anything like, I mean, he was throwing. Like, he participated. It's not like he waved it off. He obviously can play like this, but I'm like, it's very strange.
Well, well, you know, I don't mean to be Mr. Fancy Pants here, but that's cause for concern. Yeah, that is not a doctored photo. Oh, my. I almost can't look at it.
Yeah, no, it's kind of gross. Yeah, no, it's very strange to me.
Olecranon bursitis? Olecranon? Olecranon?
Sure.
That's a doctor.
It's all messed up. Whatever he's got going on.
Dr. Jesse Morse, MD here.
I know. It's very strange.
Inflammation of the bursa, which is a sad.
Yeah.
It's so weird.
I know.
Yes, I'm sorry. Like, I don't care. Like, that's, there's no such thing as, like, yeah, a good bursa sack.
I was going to say, he weighed today. The big story was that he weighed in at 210.
How much of that is bursa sack?
Correct. It's mostly bursa sack. It's a full bursa sack. If they drain that thing, he's like 199. He's like, maybe that's what he said. He's like, you know what, guys? I'll suck it up. I'll throw through the pain, but keep it in there while I weigh in. Then we can address it after the fact. I need to weigh in at over 200 pounds. And he was 210. He's 6'3", 210. And then Malik Nabers was flying.
I mean,
you can't even look at it.
How did this never pop up until Rap Sheet chose this photo today? Like, was it was it buried? Was it just, did it never come out?
I don't get it, because I've tried to read just like random people's quick assessment of the LSU Pro Day, and I don't see any of them talking about it. They're all just like, oh, Malik Nabers shined at the Pro Day. Jaden Daniels was great and blah, 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 blah. Next stop, North Carolina to go see Drake May. Like, that's what everybody is saying. But it's like, well, what about, can we circle back to this elbow here for a second?
Yeah. The fact that it looks like he's got like a typewriter's slide for an elbow.
Yeah, that's just one of the pictures. Because then this one that I'm looking at where he's just chucking the ball deep, he's actually wearing a long sleeve. So it kind of protects it a little bit.
How did he not – did anyone ask him about this at the Combine? Did anyone – has anyone asked for an auxiliary –
I don't know.
Has anyone asked for an auxiliary evaluation or examination of it? Like, I'm
sorry. Or actually, was the photo not from today? Was the photo just one that Rappaport used?
It is. The photo was one that Rappaport obviously got off of either Getty Images
got
or
it.
USA
okay,
Today.
So that was from a game this year, whereas, yeah, the Pro
he's
Day.
He's in the full LSU outfit.
Oh, yeah,
today
yeah,
he was
yeah,
just
yeah.
in, like, purple.
Purple long sleeve shirt, right.
But
right.
there was, like.
Where's the questions on that? And certain, and it's covered. Like, today the elbow was covered anyway. You wouldn't be able to see it.
I don't, like.
How far will he
sink? Two people that can talk a storm up like you and I are just absolutely at a loss for words just, over this. I mean, it looks like.
I thought it was fake. So I didn't even gasp at first. I was like, oh, that's funny. Someone's messing around. Maybe something happened with his elbow and then somebody doctored a photo. You're like, nope, I don't think that's what it is.
No, I honestly thought either A, that he had some horrendous motorcycle accident.
Yep.
In his lifetime. Or B, it was AI. Or both.
Yeah, could be something. Now, if you're into this, Jaden Daniels' hands are bigger than Drake May's and J.J. McCarthy's.
I love
like that.
If he's going to throw a curveball, maybe, you know,
yep. fork ball.
Slider, the old fork ball.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah, he said his hands were measured at 9 3/8 inches, which would have been the fourth smallest among quarterbacks who had their hands measured at the combine. However, still longer than Drake May and J.J. McCarthy.
So, are we now going to get into
hands,
Drake May and J.J. McCarthy having to go through Kenny Pickett hand stretching?
Yeah, you might want to consider it. Kenny Pickett, look at him. Can't hold on to the ball. Apparently, right. that's, although Joe Burrow also has small hands, so I don't think that really
does. Does he really?
Yeah, Joe Burrow does. Doesn't seem to matter too much.
I had no idea that it doesn't really seem to matter.
No. I mean, some guys can rise above, you know, the little tiny myths. Neighbors ran a, what, 4.35 40?
And also jumped from planet Earth to the moon and back in like
42-inch vertical.
Dude, he's going to challenge Mark. Like, there had been some stories.
He's
going to
challenge Mac McGlung for the dunk contest.
I'd pay to see him in the dunk contest
next year.
That would
be pretty cool.
No, but I think he's going to challenge Marvin Harrison Jr. potentially for wide receiver number one.
I mean, you might be right because Lance Zierlein had it like a month ago, right? He's like, I actually like my neighbors a little bit more than Harrison. And then I think that was it. And now recently there was somebody else that I think had him going higher. And I'm like, I think that's just kind of crazy. Like, as good, great as neighbors is and could be in the NFL, like, I'm not going to put somebody over Marvin Harrison. I feel like it was sort of at first there was like, hey, can we get somebody above Caleb Williams? And they tried, and they're like, no. Now let's just fight over who's second. I feel like that's what's going to happen with receivers ultimately.
Yeah. You can't convince me. There's people that are going to try to convince all of us that neighbors or somebody else should go as an offensive weapon before Marvin Harrison Jr. I just don't understand why. I mean, the quarterback play was mediocre at best last year at Ohio State, and the kids still had spectacular numbers.
Mm-hmm.
And Lord knows what they would have been if you had an even more pass-friendly offense like LSU or another one of those constant, you know, shotgun 3 and 4 wide offense.
Yeah, he didn't have Jaden Daniels throwing to him. You know, and listen, I mean, it could still work. Like, you can have all stud. Like, Joe Burrow threw to Ja'Marr Chase and Justin Jefferson, and all three of them are three of the best players in the world. So, like, you can have it that way. And maybe Daniels, Neighbors, and Thomas will be the next era of that. Like, I'm not ruling that out. I think those three guys could all be great.
What did you think, though, when you watched the cut-ups of, and there were some people that did a great job of, like, going through the tape and quickly putting together some supercuts on Twitter, like I think it's at I Am Brian Hines for Pat's Pulpit did a great job. Like, you can watch just a supercut of all the throws together. I was fine with it, but
you were whelmed.
Like, whoa, check these out.
You were whelmed. See, I think he could throw. I know there's so much attention on his running, and as a sure, like that is something that he does better than anybody else in the top part of the draft. But I think he's a good thrower of the ball. But I think we're kind of numb to these pro days, and then the guys who do choose to throw at the combine because they train so much for this, and you're like, all right, that guy's not in pads. There's no rush. There's no defense. Like, they should be able to drop back, huck at 60 yards, and make a play. Like, it's still fine, and I'm sure different scouts are looking at different things while they're doing this, but.
Well,
to mess up a pro day.
Yeah, right. That's the whole thing. If you mess up the pro day, then you're really up Blank's Creek. But, like,
yeah.
I think, you know, especially when you're going to be talking about an offense like the one that's going to be put together, I'm assuming, safely, that is, by Alex Van Pelt and company, it's probably going to be a lot of short passes based off play action, West Coast-oriented precision work, and not a lot of just, you know, spread them and shred them.
No, that's definitely true. So next stop will be North Carolina. So the Patriots get a chance to talk to Jaden Daniels today and then Drake May tomorrow. And what's crazy is it feels like there might be a chance where they'll have their choice between the two. There's so much J.J. McCarthy love. You're part of it. You're a part of that problem.
I am.
People love McCarthy.
I'm a fan. Yeah. What can I say? I celebrate the entire catalog.
And so he might jump up to two, and then suddenly the Patriots. I thought we were staring at Patriots just going to take whoever's left. And it's sort of the Commander's choice. But now it might be a real choice. Or even if the Commanders take Daniels, it sounds like the Patriots are going to have a real choice now between Drake May and J.J. McCarthy. So suddenly picking third, maybe you're not just getting the scraps of the top three. Mm-hmm. Maybe there's really truly a top four. Yep. You guys can weigh in here at 617-779-7937. These pro days, of course, the draft now 28 days, 23 hours, 44 minutes, and 56 seconds away. But we also have Major League Baseball opening day tomorrow. Red Sox taking on the Mariners. I have a six-pack of Sox questions for Fitzy. And you guys can play along as well. But right now, here is Stiz with What's Trending.
The Greg Hill Show, weekdays 6 to 10.
Now, here's What's Trending on WEEI.
All right, let's get you caught up with what's trending right now on WEEI and WEEI.com. After beating the Panthers 4-3 last night, the Bruins remained on the road as they are in Tampa Bay taking on the Lightning. Right now, the first period just ended, and we have a tie game, 1-1. Tampa has been on a roll during the second half of their season. They've gone 28-2 in their last 30 games to seize control of the first wild card spot in the Eastern Conference. Linus Allmark is in the net for your Boston Bruins. Celtics have the night off tonight. Their road trip continues tomorrow night. They remain in Atlanta taking on the Hawks. The Hawks managed to crawl back from a 30-point deficit, beating the Celtics 120-118 on Monday night. Celtics hope to get some get back tomorrow night at the State Farm Arena. Tip off at 7:30. And the Jordan Montgomery sweepstakes now officially over, as it was reported that the left-handed pitcher has agreed to a free agent deal with the Arizona Diamondbacks pending a physical. However, according to Jeff Passan of ESPN, the Red Sox have acquired right-hander Naoyuki Uwasawa from the Rays. According to reports, the right-hander triggered an assignment clause and the Rays were close to making a trade for him. The Rays will receive cash considerations. I'm Stiz. That's what's trending now on WEI and WEI.com. More Rich Keefe Show coming up.
The Greg Hill Show.
I don't understand what the issue is. They got...
Just download the Odyssey app. That's A-U-D-A-C-Y.
Say W-E-E-I's a favorite and listen wherever you go.
Now, more of the Rich Keefe Show
on W-E-E-I.
Back here on the Rich Keefe Show with Fitzy, W-E-E-I. You guys can join the program at 617-779-7937. Hit us up on Twitter or Instagram at Rich Keefe Show. And Fitzy, before we get to the six-pack of socks questions for the upcoming season.
I can't wait.
Did you see NFL draft scout Matt Miller had a new seven-round mock draft?
Yes, I believe our Mike Kadlick
from
WEI.com. Tweeted it out earlier today. I only saw some of the early results, and there were not a lot of happy respondents.
No, I for one am not happy. I will get to what his results were. But first, I also think at this stage of the game, if you're not going to do a seven-round mock draft, don't do a mock draft. Do the whole thing. Be committed. Here's my first-round mock. Save it. Give me a seven-round mock draft. I want to know that you know 250 players or whatever it is. Give me every single guy, every single trade, every single team. Either do it or don't.
Now I've given you over the course of the last several, God, it feels like years, but it's only been weeks or months we've been talking NFL draft. I believe I've given you some other players that I've begun crushing on.
Yes,
if you will.
Matter of fact, you have. Yes.
You know, like Javon Baker, the receiver who somebody is going to grab in like the third round or fourth round probably and turn into Puka Nacua 2.0.
Yeah.
But some of these other, some like, oh, here we go. Matt Miller's.
You got it. So I'm looking at it right now. So what he had the Patriots do, Matt Miller, NFL draft scout. So the one thing I do respect is the full mock. However, he had them trading down from three. So already I don't like it. Doesn't mean it's not possible. It could happen. He's got him going down from three with the Vikings to 11-23. So he's got him taking Olu Fashanu, the tackle from Penn State, at 11. And then cornerback Cooper DeJean at 23.
That's the first head scratcher because, again, you could have... The other day, traded a third rounder to get one of the top five corners in football and just paid him fair market.
Yeah.
Without having to spend a first round. I don't understand that one in the least.
He's the Iowa corner. Some have him as low as like the fifth best corner in the draft. But I mean, that's all up for debate. But
do the Patriots really?
Don't draft a defensive player, maybe at all, let alone in the first three rounds.
We just drafted a corner in the first round last year.
I hate it. So I really dislike. Then he has him taking back-to-back receivers, Keon Coleman at 34, and then all the way down 68, Jalen McMillan. And
no, he's good. McMillan's going to be the real deal, I think.
You like McMillan? Yeah, Keon Coleman might even be. I mean, he's got him 34, so clearly could be in the first round.
Although I did see today that our boy on the Rich Keefe Show NFL 2024 All-Draft Team name list.
Yeah.
Bub Means.
Bub.
Bub, Big Bad Bub, came in 15 pounds heavier from the end of the season.
Packed down to a little bit of weight.
Yeah, the Bub
muscle,
buzz
though,
is
we
real.
Think? Okay. Well, speaking of the all-name team, at 137, he's got him taking tight end Tip Riemann.
That's what I'm talking about.
Tip Riemann. But in between the Jalen McMillan, the Washington receiver, the other Washington receiver, and then Tip Riemann, he's got him taking a quarterback at 103. Spencer Rattler.
103, the Rattler.
The Rattler. What a curious case Spencer Rattler is. So he was at Oklahoma, and he had a good freshman year, and he was considered a stud. He was one of those guys that they thought was going to be the first to really cash in on the NIL. Mm-hmm. He designed his own logo. They're like, this guy can't miss. This guy's incredible. You know, you think about Oklahoma quarterbacks prior to him, it was Baker Mayfield who won the Heisman. Jalen Hurts, who was great. Kyler Murray won the Heisman. Or no, he didn't win the Heisman, but whatever. Those guys were studs. Number one picks in the draft. And you thought he was going to be next in line. And then next thing you know, his sophomore year, they're like, Caleb Williams is better. He kind of got off to a slow start. They put in Caleb Williams. Caleb Williams was great. So then Lincoln Riley leaves, goes to Southern Cal, takes Caleb Williams with him, but Spencer Rattler had already transferred to South Carolina to play out the rest of his days, and kind of a mixed bag there, right? Like, there were some good moments with him. There were some, like, oh, I don't really know if he has it. but he got a bunch of like SEC playing time. But he's the next name, I feel like, Fitzy, after the, I guess it's six if you include Penix, like the six quarterbacks. I don't know where he gets drafted, but he's the next guy. And is there a chance that he is the next third, fourth round pick that actually cracks a lineup in the NFL?
I mean, if he's able to dig back deep into what made him the potential first overall pick a couple of years ago in people's eyes, then there is. But again, it goes back to what we were talking about last night, Rich. All of these guys can throw the football. All of these guys have been playing quarterback long enough that I think there's a fundamental belief from Caleb Williams to Spencer Rattler, from Drake May and mm-hmm. Jaden Daniels to Bo Nix and the dude from Western Kentucky, Tulane, and beyond. Yeah, they all can play football. It's a matter of who's got the it factor and what system are they put in and how long do they get to develop. If you see mechanical issues or if you see things you need to work on with Drake May, mm-hmm. but you just say like, F it, we'll just throw him out there. You know, hey, it's a first-round pick. You should play if it's first-round quarterback. Like, there's a chance you may mess him up. Mm-hmm. If you let him marinate for a while and work on his fundamentals and let him watch the pro game and acclimate, then maybe, just maybe, you could pick up a diamond in the rough late third, fourth round.
But you can't take Rattler as the plan. You know, that's way too low. You just can't do it.
That's so more of a flyer.
It is. And it you know, with this current roster of Jacoby Brissett, like if your quarterback room is Jacoby Brissett, Bailey Zappi, and Spencer Rattler, I feel like
you're be taking the under on that 4.5.
Yeah, and then like so, and then now we gotta scout the quarterbacks in the 2025 draft class. Like that's what it seems like you're doing. Like he's just not the right fit personnel wise. Like maybe you have a young quarterback that you're not 100% sure on, like I don't know, somebody else. Maybe you take him. Like, even like Miami. Like, what are they going to do with Tua? Maybe you take Rattler. Maybe you kind of like him in camp and you kind of figure it out. But I don't like it for the Patriots. All right. So anyway, that was the seven-round mock draft. He had them taking a kicker, actually, in the sixth round as well.
Good. Yeah. Nothing I want to do more than take more kickers.
Yeah.
More guards.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. CBS, by the way, their latest mock, which came out an hour ago. Overall, first Caleb Williams, second pick to Washington, Drake May, Jaden Daniels, third to the Patriots, and then Minnesota moves up to number four with the Cardinals.
Is that because of the elbow picture?
Yep.
Daniels dropped from 2 to 3 because of the elbow. Looks crazy.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Right. And then JJ McCarthy goes fourth to Minnesota, which would make them very happy, which would allow Jim Harbaugh, who just talked up a storm about offensive line at the owners' meetings.
It's all about it.
God, what a Harbaugh conversation that was.
Seriously.
He could have his choice between Joe Alt, Fashanu, or Marvin Harrison at five, which would be wild.
It would be. Like, who's Justin Herbert going to throw to?
This draft is so receiver rich. They could take a receiver in the third and fourth round, yeah. And both of them might be studs.
That's true. And then in the right spot, I guess, they probably would be kind of go like the Packers route. Take second and third, fourth round receivers and try to hit it because you have a good offensive coach and you have Herbert. So I guess, yeah, they could do it. Although Marvin Harrison and Malik Nabers are going to be pretty enticing for somebody at the top in pairing them with either Kyler Murray or Herbert or somebody.
From Jump Street, they should be good.
All right, let's get to our six-pack of Sox questions for the upcoming season. Fitz, let me start with this. Who will be the Red Sox all-star or all-stars this year? Of course, every major league team has to have one. Who will it be?
I'm going to say that representing your Boston Red Sox at the 2024 All-Star Game will be first baseman Tristan Casas.
I agree with you. And I think there's a chance it might only be Casas because I think the team's not going to be very good, so it's hard to get that tiebreaker, like, oh, we need this other guy. I'm sure Devers' numbers will be sort of in the conversation, but it just feels like, I don't know, Casas is the guy, and first base isn't exactly loaded in the American League. So I like that. I think he's going to be the guy. He's like my one breakout candidate for the whole thing.
He's like my one thing I'm looking forward to seeing happen or develop. And by the way, Rich, based off of last night and that tremendous Tier Tuesday segment we had,
crushed it.
We lumped all the teams together into different tiers named for the best and worst ballpark snacks.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
The 2024 Major League All-Star Game will be at the ballpark in Arlington, Globe Life, or whatever the hell they call it.
Hey,
so
like
we could go.
Yeah, let's do it.
We do a show trip.
Let's do it.
Go get some boomsticks.
I don't see why we don't. Question number two, what player or which player has the most pressure on them this season?
Trevor Story.
Ooh. Yeah, people want to be like, all right, what's the deal? I was just talking to Bradford last hour about Trevor Story because he's been here for two seasons. He's missed more games than he's played in. Mm-hmm. And he can't, like, it's a decent contract. He's also one of the reasons many people think Xander Bogaerts is no longer here. Mm-hmm. And so what is he going to do? And, like, right now, I think they got him penciled third in the lineup in between Devers and Casas. So even on a not very good team, that's a great spot to be hitting in the order. He has 30 home run power. So, yeah, is he finally going to do something? That was a decent contract that he signed. And,
I'm sorry. I'm just looking at the Red Sox roster on ESPN.com right now. Yeah. I think I recognize, like...
you know all these guys. You know these fellows.
This is the most unimpressive roster.
That's not great.
I mean, if they win, it is such an in spite of themselves and or our expectations... scrappy dappy do type of effort these guys put, honestly. But back to the it's unbelievable. But like, how, what are you gonna say? Like, look at the outfield. You're gonna tell me that this is a Ref Snyder referendum year? Tyler O'Neill, Durant? No. Durant is a flaw. Hopefully,
Durant. Maybe I'll hold out a little bit of hope on Durant. He had a really exciting time for like a couple months last year.
And but he's not under pressure though.
Oh no, not under pressure. No, not under pressure. It's got to be Story. I would say Devers, because Devers' contract, usually you look to like the highest paid guy on the team. So he signs the crazy big contract. So Devers' Story got to be, as far as players, right? Not counting Cora, not saying like Breslow or Henry. If it's just the players, it's probably limited just to those guys on the left side of the infield.
You can't possibly tell me that there's any one pitcher in this bullpen or in this rotation. I mean, Chris Martin and Kenley Jansen may be auditioning for jobs on other teams at this point.
Yeah.
But none of the start. How could Brian Bayo's under no pressure? He signed a long-term deal.
None.
You're asking Pivetta and Whitlock and Winkowski and Houck.
It also speaks to the team that, like, they don't have big contracts. So the only two that are currently on a big contract are, like, the guys that are under the most pressure. Devers to sort of take his game to that next level, and Story just to be just to play, really.
Yeah, how about just play 140 games? To live up to a piece of the contract, because it's like he's stolen money the last 2 years.
Yeah, I agree. All right, which player do you think is flying under the radar? Could be a same answer from before, or could be somebody different.
For me, it's Jarren Duran.
Okay. Yeah.
I because, like you said, when healthy, when the young man has his mentals and his physicals in check, He's capable of a lot. He's dynamic.
He's a fun leadoff hitter. He's fast, takes the extra base.
And did a nice job of spinning around. My God, is he jacked.
Yeah.
But he's done a nice job of coming back from those end of 2022 comments, which I feel like he made.
Oof, that was rough. Yeah.
I remember we were none too pleased about that.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't feel like he made those. I almost feel like those are made out of like some sort of anxiety that he had for full well knowing like, hey, this team's in a bad, you know, I should say something. Like,
that's not
say less, fam.
Not your strength, right? And then the next year, like, yeah, because I was completely out on him. I'm like, why is he even on the team? And then he completely won me over. Like his style of play, I was like, all right, I'll take this guy. Like, okay, why not? And then he gets hurt, which is so unfortunate. Like, so you didn't get to cap off what could have been a good full season. The guy that I think his name's never been brought up. Is Masataka Yoshida. There was some trade speculation early, and then that went away. Then there was like, all right, they're going to move him to DH. He's primarily going to be a DH. But he was pretty good last year and then cooled off at the end. He was the rookie of the year favorite for a while and then slipped to fourth, I think, third or fourth. But he's kind of flown under the radar. There's not a lot of buzz at all about him. And if he puts together a quality season, like, all right, then... You know, the lineup, as much as you say, like, and I'm with you, like, there are some gentlemen on the roster that a lot of fans are not familiar with. But if their top five in the lineup is Duran, Devers, Story, Casas, Yoshida, there's a lot worse around
that
baseball.
That dog can hunt.
Yep.
Yeah, and look, it could be a combination of things. Number one, it could be Yoshida now finally acclimating to the rigors of the 162-game schedule because the Japanese baseball schedule is shorter, number one.
Mm-hmm.
And number two, if he is going to DH more than he's going to play left field this year, that may also take a little wear and tear off of him.
Yeah.
So he may be
a more kind of awkward in the field.
Kind of.
I know that wall's right there and it's very tall, it's very intimidating, but you do play all of your home games there. And if Manny Ramirez could figure it out, I feel like you also have the ability to figure out the left field wall.
Yeah.
All right, question number four. Will this be Alex Cora's last season with the Red Sox?
It will indeed, and unfortunately, be Alex Cora's last season managing the Red Sox.
All right, sort of follow. This doesn't count as the fifth question, but this is sort of a follow-up to that one. Does he make it through the entire season?
Yes.
Yeah, I kind of feel like it might be one of those things where it's like, hey, like, to give you a big extension, we kind of need the team to be better. The team's not going to be that much better. We can't really fully blame you for it either, so we're not going to embarrass you by firing you during the season, but we're also going to go in different directions. And then Cora, too, might also not want to be here. You know, Jones was asking him about it today, and he's like, well, they haven't talked to us, but I haven't really talked to them, so I don't think he's in a hurry to be locked up long-term unless they really make it worth his while, and it doesn't appear as though they're willing to spend a lot of money anywhere, so I don't think he would be on the manager.
See, I think it's actually going to be of his accord. I think he's going to say, No, I can get a job. I'm going to take a year off. I'll get another job somewhere else. This has been a mess. I deserve better, and I don't know which direction you guys are going in, and I don't really feel like being in a top five baseball market and working with bottom 10 budget.
Yeah.
No thanks.
Yep.
Yeah, I think he's super underappreciated, and I know the teams have consistently underwhelmed defensively, especially in the infield in the last couple of years, but I don't think that's to such a detriment that the team, you know, that's ultimately what's holding them back. And if they fire him in season, Rich, like this organization, Fenway Sports Group especially, can't afford more bad press and bad optics.
Yeah.
That would just look horrible. Like, oh, really? You guys did this? What a shocker.
He's one of the more likable guys still on the team. And I know he has some of his detractors and people get pissed at certain decisions he makes. And that's fine. He's the manager of the Red Sox. Like, that should happen. But yeah, he's definitely one of the guys that I think more people like than don't. All right. Question number five, because you were talking about the direction of the team, it feels like Craig Breslow inherited this minor league system left to him by Chaim Bloom and is immediately just saying the same stuff. And he's like, Marcelo Meyer and Roman Anthony and Kyle Teal, like, these guys are the future and they need to be really good. They're all in AA. They're not supposed to be here this year, but do they get a little impatient? Do we see Meyer, Anthony, or Teal at the big league level this year?
I kind of almost want to put it in this order. Anthony, Teal, Meyer. I think
Roman Anthony would be the first one out of those three we see.
Yep, and then yep. I think Kyle Teal. Yeah. I think this kid's going to be solid. And also when you've got Connor Wong and Reese McGuire.
I mean, the temptation's going to be there because if any or all of these guys rip the cover off it for a couple of months and then the Red Sox are kind of floundering and then maybe you throw in a couple of injuries, there's going to be like, well, why the hell not? You remember, like, this is going back a ways, but clamoring for guys like Ellsbury or like even Buchholz to make a start or like you heard so much about these guys and you're like, get them up here. Let's see it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you don't want to burn them if they're not ready. You don't want to, Craig Hanson them, but still. Or Clay Meredith. I think Francona even still admits that Clay Meredith one he kind of botched. All right, what is your projected win total for the Boston Red Sox? This is the sixth and final question.
I think the Boston Red Sox are going to go 82-80.
How do you like that? So Stiz and Fitzy with the over. Very good.
That's right. Exactly. I'm 80, not saying not it's going to be a lot over. Exactly. But
no.
Over 78 and a half.
What do you got, Rich?
I'm going 79-83. Exactly. Yes. One game better than the last two seasons.
So you're smashing the over too.
I guess so.
That is a gentle
dusting of the over.
So earlier on, it was at 80.5, then 79.5. And I was like, I'm taking the under on both. And then it's continued to lower because I think – I don't know if Vegas thought they were getting Jordan Montgomery or if they thought they were doing something else and they never did, because it's been like a steady kind of game. Every couple of weeks, I feel like they've taken a game off. So I got him as having a losing record, and I think it's going to be – it would be actually hilarious if they had 78 wins for the third year in a row, which is very much on the table.
It would be hilarious in a very perverted definition of the word hilarious.
Yeah. Not like where you're so sad, you're just crying. You don't know what emotion to feel. But that's the Red Sox. The season starts tomorrow. We're roughly 24 hours away from the first pregame show of the year. Me and Stiz will have you covered for that bad boy. 9-10 leading up until the 10-10 first pitch, which I know I'm happy they're opening up on the road because although today, this afternoon ended up being good weather, but imagine if they played like yesterday or the day before, would have been the pits.
Well, what about tomorrow? I mean, how would you like to just go?
What's the weather tomorrow?
Rain.
Okay. Yeah. So, no, I'm glad they're opening up on the road, but it kind of stings that they're not playing during the day. And even if it was like 5 o'clock because it's West Coast time, like 10-10 for the, I know I sound like an old dude and I work a night shift, but still. Opening day, the sun should be shining for opening day.
No, I agree with that.
Oh, you're having trouble reading the forecast? You want to get your readers out, Rich?
I'll get my readers out. I can complain about stuff. I got no problem doing that. All right, Kiefer Madness comes your way next. And because there's been so many freaking remakes out, Fitzy and I just watched Roadhouse, which we should have. The Crow remake is coming out. Don't Tell Mom the Babysitter's Dead remake is coming out. Oh, you heard me right. So there's been so many bad ones. We're going to each do our top five of the best, so top five movie remakes during Kiefer Madness coming up next.
From the Rubenstein Law Studios, 1-800-BOS-LEGAL. This is WEEI.
Twitch.tv/Rich.com.
You can watch the show anytime via our live stream on Twitch. Just go to Twitch.tv/BostonWEEI and check out WEEI on YouTube for our video on demand content updated daily. Now, more of the Rich Keefe Show on WEEI. It's time for Kiefer Madness.
Kiefer Madness!
Richard Keefe, I think it is. Rich Keefe.
Who is that?
How are you doing, ladies and gentlemen? My name is Joshua Adams.
What now?
It's Kiefer Madness.
Where's Keefe? Where is he?
Where's Keefe?
Where is Keefe?
Hey, Keefe, you're a douche.
I was doing Junko Inoshima from Danganronpa.
I'm a firm believer in UFOs and Sasquatch.
That's funny.
Yo, Kiefer Madness is so hit or miss.
Keefe's a nice guy.
Keefe's a nice guy. Okay.
Kiefer Madness?
It's Kiefer Madness on WEEI.
I bring it.
The King County Prosecutor's Office says this is a reminder. Life is not like the movies.
Avengers, something with the Ultron. I don't know what it is. Something with the Ultron.
Truthfully, it was involving pickles.
All right, here we are. Time for Kiefer Madness on the Rich Keefe Show with Fitz here on WEEI. And as we were mentioning earlier, there's been a ton of movie remakes really over the last several years. But it seems like all of a sudden... Roadhouse just came out. The Crow trailer just came out. That's in theaters, I think, in June. Don't Tell Mom the Babysitter's Dead is coming out in April. And there's just a bunch more. There's scores more. And so most of them are bad. However, some of them are very good. So let's do our top five movie remakes of all time. Stiz, I know you have a hard time ranking things. So do you just have a pile of five?
Yes, I would like
to. Okay, you have a pile of five. All right, you can go. You have a pile of five. Fitzy, why don't you go first? Give me your go five through one.
Wait, Rich, that is a great name for our ranking segment.
A pile of five. Like, that one could be one. That one could be one. I don't know. Here's just five that I have.
It's like it's top five movie rankings.
All right, a pile of five.
Okay, coming in at number five, this is a remake of a foreign movie called Infernal Affairs. What, do you want to just chop me up and feed me to the poor?
Yep.
Some may say it is the best Boston movie ever made. Give me The Departed.
Wow. Yep. How about that? Yep.
That's on my list, too.
You like The Departed more than The Town?
I do.
You like it more than Good Will Hunting?
Actually, 2006 is The Departed, I believe.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Probably, like, on par with Good Will Hunting. Good Will Hunting is a great movie. Like,
yeah.
The Departed is just, like, it's great. It's a terrific, terrific, terrific movie.
I like the... I think Jack Nicholson's a bit much in it. A little much. Some of the stuff is great. Like, Alec Baldwin and Mark Wahlberg are hilarious. Damon and DiCaprio are really good. But All right, so coming in at number five. All right, very good. The Departed. What else you got?
Okay, coming in at number four. This a remake of an American classic starring perhaps Pilgrim, one of the greatest American action and Western stars of all time. Give me 2010 surprise Coen Brothers film, True Grit.
Good one. That was one of the first texts into the program here once we said we were doing this, this top five list. True Grit. Yeah, very good. Oh, I didn't think I was going to like it as much as I did.
Oh,
yep.
It's because it's just straightforward. Matt Damon, very good. Haley Steinfeld, what a find.
Yep.
This was back when Jeff Bridges came back into the forefront as just an eclectic, spectacular leading man. His Rooster Cogburn is...
Better
than John Wayne's. It's just that he's not John Wayne, but what a movie.
Yeah, that voice that he does in that movie, and what was the TV show that he just did? That
the
remember?
Old Man.
Yeah, which was great to see, then it really petered off a cliff. But that was like
Yeah,
I can listen to that voice in like doses. I couldn't listen to that every day.
You can't read the rest of that one.
Like you can open your mouth a little bit if you want to talk. You're allowed to open. No, you don't want to open it? That's fine. All right, what's number three?
Coming in at number three, this movie is officially from 2006. Ba-da-boom, ba-da-ba-da-ba. A remake of one of the first Bond films, and a silly one at that. It is the original James Bond novel as well. It introduced us to maybe some people's favorite James Bond, the most badass of them all, Daniel Craig in Casino Royale.
Wow. Casino Royale. Yeah, good one. What do you think of the new Bond, Aaron Taylor Johnson?
Love it.
Yeah, that's a good one, huh?
I think he's excellent. Kick-Ass? Yeah, he was also super good in Karate Train or whatever the hell the name of that Brad Pitt one was 2 years ago.
That was Bullet Train.
Same thing.
Bullet Train. Now, it's going to be funny because he is in a movie coming out this year called Kraven the Hunter, which is a great Spider-Man villain. It's also Kraven's Last Hunt is one of the great comic books ever written. However, this is like a Sony production. This is in like the Madame Web type area. It's going to be a disaster. Early prediction is it's going to be a disaster. I don't know if it'll, I don't think it'll stick to him. He can go and do the Bond movies, but he does have a good filmography, this guy, but that one I'm guessing is going to be trash. What was it?
Probably so, but I'm looking forward to his interpretation.
Yeah.
A little young, handsome Bond I'm good with. There are a couple other, as long as they didn't go with the Chalamet. Number two, some may say this is Schwarzenegger's finest film, one of many great James Cameron films, a remake of a French, beloved French comedy turned into an American action classic, True Lies.
Is that probably why they got Tom Arnold? They're trying to lean a little bit comedy there, like try to get some of those jokes in.
Although, it's a surprisingly funny movie.
It is funny, yeah. In a young Elijah Dushku, I believe, Watertown's own, as the daughter, right?
That sequence in the go back and still watch it now. 30 years later, it holds up. The scene in the limo over the bridge in the Keys with the Harrier jets and the missiles and every. Oh my God!
Yeah, it's fun. That's a fun movie. Number one,
probably John. Some say John Carpenter's best film. Certainly, I think maybe one of the scariest movies of all time. An incredible remix as atmospheric to the date. The Thing from 1982.
Oh, it's incredible. It's awesome. Yeah, we talk about it every Halloween, just be like, it doesn't get enough credit for being a horror movie. I think there's a lot of horror movies to be considered. I think it's an easy genre to remake for whatever reason. Maybe because there were so many classics like forever ago and you want to reboot them, or there's like Japanese ones that you want to make in America or whatever.
Well, I'll tell you, if we were doing the worst movie remakes, A Nightmare on Elm Street would certainly be number one on my list.
Yeah. Or Halloween Shops or Halloween Fails or...
Halloween Ends is one of the worst movies I've ever seen.
Busta Rhymes kills...
Did you like
Uncle
Jackie
Myers.
Earl Haley's?
I like,
though,
I
no,
like Jackie,
that wasn't bad.
Yeah, I like Jackie Earl Haley's performance, but the script was horrible. It was just horrible.
All right, Stiz, what's your pile of five?
All right, my pile of five is, you were just mentioning horror movies, like Chinese horror movies that were adapted as American. The Ring. So The Ring is up there for me. I had The Departed up there as well.
Okay.
A Star is Born. A Star is Born actually might be my
Which
number
one. They've remade that like four times.
The most recent one with Bradley Cooper and Lady Gaga.
Tell me something still.
Yeah, I love that. War of the Worlds with Tom Cruise.
Yeah.
Yes. What,
that movie is scary as hell.
Is that the Dakota Fanning? Dakota Fanning in that one?
Yep,
Dakota Fanning. That's a good movie.
And then you got Nick especially might give me guff for this one, but Sandler's The Longest Yard.
Okay, this has been the Rich Keefe Show with Stiz. Joe Braverman is in for the fourth hour.
Yeah, The Longest Yard.
Oh my God. And
maybe
I love Sandler,
age,
but good
maybe
Lord.
My age, because I grew, you know, that was the one that I experienced first. But
man.
It's like a comfort movie for me.
How dare the original Longest Yard, it deserves to be hung in the Louvre. You deserve to be hung outside.
Burt Reynolds. Who else is in the original?
Nick Nolte was in North.
All
Dallas
you needed
40.
Was Burt Reynolds.
Yeah, true.
You had me at Burt Reynolds.
All you needed back then. Is that five?
Yes, that was
okay.
Five. Yeah.
All right. So mine,
I can't wait to hear all of our, like, for your considerations are almost rants. Rich, what do you got, buddy?
They're very good. Not a lot of overlap here. One very much overlap. I liked Dawn of the Dead.
Ooh,
Zack Snyder's Dawn of the Dead.
That's right.
Both Dawn of the Deads are great, but the 2004 version I thought was fantastic.
Might be, a good movie.
Ocean's 11. Ocean's 11.
Solid choice.
Fun, super fun movie. All-star cast, but I like it. Ocean's 12, not nearly as good. Ocean's 13, a little bit better. But Ocean's 11 is a fantastic movie. I also am a big fan. Coming in number three on my list would be Robert De Niro, Cape Fear. Cape Fear from 1991.
Counselor!
The original came out in like the 60s. This one came out in the 90s. Now, this one...
Legendary performance in that movie.
Oh, yeah. This one, number two, I think it counts, but what's different about it is the original tried to do it all in one movie, and now the remakes are doing it over a series of three movies, but Dune.
Yeah.
Dune technically counts, so I'm going to put Dune at number two.
I almost chose Dune.
And then I agree with Fitz, I have The Thing as number one. In fact, when I first saw The Thing, I don't think I knew it was a remake. And then somebody told me later on, and I'm like, oh, okay.
I only knew it was a remake when I saw it in high school, Rich, because when I asked my dad when I first started getting into the idea of maybe seeing my first horror movie but still being too scared to see one, I asked my dad, what was the scariest movie you saw as a kid? And he said The Thing from Outer Space.
Oh, no kidding. Yeah, no, this one was was great. I agree with you, Stiz. The Ring is a really good one, especially if you're taking like Japanese movies. So there's a lot of horror movies that they've done that for. Another horror movie, I think it was Switzerland, maybe. They did Let the Right One In, and then the American version was Let Me In. So it was also really good. Matt Reeves actually directed that one, Let Me In.
Yeah, I just watched the original a few weeks ago, based on a recommendation for the first time, because I knew it was like classic, but yes, I hadn't seen it.
Good movie.
Yeah, I loved
it. The original is a little bit better.
It is.
Yeah. Our friend Maddie Blake had me watch that.
Also in my honorable mention pile, The Birdcage, 310 to Yuma, Dread, His Girl Friday, Ocean's 11.
Dread, great call.
Yeah, but basically like Judge Dredd. It was the raid for Judge Dredd. It was awesome.
Scarface is a remake.
And Last of the Mohicans.
Last of the Mohicans.
Yeah, Scarface is a remake, and I would argue the original is better.
Really?
Paul Mooney, 1931 or 2, I think.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Watched it in college. I don't like the Pacino one. I don't. I think it's so like overrated. I feel like people now it's kind of like people either love it or they hate it. Some of the other ones on the text line were King Kong. Mm-hmm. That's true. You can do a lot of those like big monster movies that we made. Texas Chainsaw Massacre. I do like the remake, but
yeah,
I mean,
it's
the original.
Right. Not
great.
The original. No.
Somebody was asking, would you consider The Dark Knight a remake?
No, I don't.
I think they're not really remakes. They're sort of taking like an established property and they're doing their own kind of thing with it. So I don't know if those count. Sneaking a call here during the madness. We have Vanessa in Medway. What do you got, Vanessa?
Hello?
Yeah, all right. All right.
Hey, Vanessa.
Vanessa, how's it going tonight? All right, we got 3 hours down. You guys can feel free, 37937 on the text line, or you can hit us up on Twitter and Instagram, at Rich Keefe Show, Best Movie Remakes. We have Can I Get a Ruling coming up next, plus Grab Bag on the way. So go nowhere. 1 hour to go here on the Rich Keefe Show with Fitzy, WEEI.
Gresh and Fourier.
Trying to please everybody so much. And I don't even know if that's him. I have no idea if that's Gerard Mayo, the coach that we will eventually see. Right now, he is a rookie head coach trying to please too many people, trying to right too many wrongs. Suddenly, the gates have been closed forever, and Willy Wonka decided to throw out, you know, 7 golden tickets, and now the factory is open. It's just chaos.
Did you miss something? Listen to the pod.
EEI Studios. 93.7 WEEI-FM and HD1. Lawrence, Boston. We're always live on the free Odyssey app.
Towards the final hour of the Rich Keefe Show with Fitzy here on WEEI. You guys can join the program at 617-779-7937. Before we get to Can I Get a Ruling and then Grab Bag, this is from Jim Nagy of the Senior Bowl. Mm-hmm. He tweeted out, we were talking about the Jaden Daniels and the LSU Pro Day, and it wasn't even anything from the Pro Day, but it was a photo that Ian Rappaport used of Jaden Daniels that had his elbow looking very strange, and then everybody talking about the elbow the rest of the day, but nobody else is really taking the cheese. It's really just like a like an internet thing. But Nagy says, an LSU staffer told me today that if Jaden Daniels had opted to run a 40, it would have been similar to Brian Thomas's 4.34 official combine time. And then he adds, I love how Jaden threw it today, but I wish we could have seen that. Yeah, like that,
a
I don't...
Sub 4.4?
Yeah, but that's what they're like, then do it.
Yeah, if you're that fast. And, oh, no. Oh, he only got a 4.42? Gee whiz, what a slowpoke. Yeah,
bum. What a bum. But, like, I don't know. A lot of the times these guys skip things at the combine. And I'm like, well, if you're a super top draft pick, I don't really hold it against you. Like, fine. But then they're like, well, I'll do it at the pro day. It's like, well, I'm only going to do so much at the pro day. It's like, well, then I don't want to hear a guy that works there being like, he would have ran a 4.3. It's like, just say he's fast. Like, he didn't run the 4.3. He chose not to. I guess he something about it, he must have been scared off not to run the 4.3, so he didn't. He doesn't get credit for a 4.3 if he didn't run a 4.3.
I don't understand why you wouldn't run if you could run. If your peak would be 4.3, yeah, but you run a 4.4, you're still going to be one of the fastest, one of the absolute fastest quarterbacks in the NFL, and that is going to give every general manager and personnel director another reason to want to select.
Yeah,
it doesn't make any sense to me.
I don't get it. Based on our previous conversation about movie remakes, a texter said we forgot the new Blade Runner, which I would say that's more of a sequel than it is
a
remake.
More like a sequel than a remake to me.
Yeah, I know it's a thin line sometimes. Reboot. That's why Scream has the requels, because like Scream 5 is actually just called Scream, but it kind of takes place in the same universe. So that's really more of a reboot or a sequel than anything else.
Yeah.
Let's go to Eddie in Lowell. Eddie, what do you got, sir?
Hey, how you guys doing?
Doing great.
So I want to get your thoughts on the Rob Zombie Halloween, because I think that's pretty badass. And then not based, his other movies are remakes, but what do you think about The House of a Thousand Corpses? Well, because I know he's polarizing.
I actually am quite a fan. I'm a huge fan of Rob Zombie. I love The Devil's Rejects. I think that's the best movie he's done.
Wow. I've never seen that, by the
way. Oh, it's incredible. It's one of my five favorite horror movies.
Over House.
Yes.
Wow.
Well, it's a little bit more real.
Yeah.
House is crazy, and if you like that, cool.
Yeah, yeah.
But they take those characters, and then they put them in stuff, and it's not supernatural at all in Rejects. And I love it. Soundtrack is insane. The Diamond Dallas Page, Danny Trejo combo, The Unholy Two, awesome characters that should have had a spinoff movie. But love Rejects. I liked the Halloween, not more than the original, obviously, but I liked the first one he did. The second one is trash, though. Zombies Halloween 2 is one of the worst Halloween movies, and that's saying something.
He barely has a mask on in part two.
It stinks. That one
but
stinks.
But Rob Zombie's original Halloween,
I like that one enough.
I like
so many different spins on how. My God, mm-hmm. there were the Halloweens in the late '90s with like what was it H2O with Jamie Lee Curtis.
Yeah, that was sort of a re. That was so. We want to go down this road.
There's so many universes.
It was Halloween 2, then Halloween 3 that didn't have Myers, and then there's a little bit of a break, and then they did 4, 5, and 6, which were all kind of shared. Then they did Halloween H2O, which ignores 4, 5, and 6. And then there was Halloween Resurrection, which came out after H2O, which was in the same universe. Then there was a long pause. Then there was Rob Zombie's 1 and 2, which were their own thing. Then there's another long pause. And then Danny McBride came out with 3 movies. The first one was pretty good. Second one, worse. Third one, all-time worse. And there are reports out there that they're going to reboot it again.
Well, they're to a TV show.
Oh, it is? It's not a movie?
TV show.
Still enough.
Come on. Still enough is enough.
The guy in the white mask sells.
Can I get a ruling on Halloween reboots and remakes?
Yeah, how many sequels before you have to start a public outcry to stop ruining a great property? Like, do we need to all picket outside of the freaking studio?
Change.org instead of to make another season.
Get a
petition.
Stop it.
All right, it is time for Can I Get a Ruling Wednesday night around this time. And, of course, baseball season coming up, so these may be few and far between. So, Fitzy, why don't you lead off this week? What do you got for Can I Get a Ruling?
Okay, so this happens a lot at sporting events, but it happened to me earlier today as I went to go see my wee one in a little school musical. The whole entire idea of when you're at in some sort of public forum, people not just taking photos, but standing and videoing. How long before you're allowed to say to somebody like, okay.
Can we maybe enjoy it now? Possible?
Yeah, could you just, like, I can't watch the show or I can't see the game because you're standing up for minutes at a time to film your son or daughter, sing, dance, play lacrosse, etc. Like, so what's a generally accepted amount of time for somebody to, like, want to capture the moment for sport? Or, you know,
I feel like if, especially if there's a chance they're in somebody's way, I think it's like 30 seconds.
That's what I was thinking.
30 second video, you can send that off. Now, there are certain times where, hey, maybe you want to film a big chunk of it so you can send it to a grandparent or something like that, but you can't be in anybody's way. You got to find the spot that, like, you know, maybe it's like between shoulders and you're like, all right, here's where I am, or stand up way in the back. Yeah. You can't be in somebody's way and film for certainly longer than a minute.
Yeah, like, you're not going to, like, pass the phone down the aisle at the ballpark the same way they do with, like, bags of peanuts and hot dogs. Like, hey, excuse me, would you mind, sir, in the aisle seat, would you film this next sequence for me, please?
No, I'm not.
But it's just so obnoxious. Somebody stands up, they got their derriere right in your face, and, like, for 3-4 minutes at a time, like, sit down.
I can't
stand it.
All right, mine, this could come up whether it be, I think, ideally, or most often in, say, like, a double date. Not that, again, when you have little kids, it's hard to pull that off anyway. But let's
see. Last time you went on a date with your wife, period. You have two kids like I do.
No, it was actually not too long ago because it was for my birthday. And my wife and my best friend and his wife, we went out. And my sister-in-law was in town, so she watched the kids for the few hours that we were gone. And, like, I don't remember the time prior to that. So, yes. But so that was a different situation because it was a birthday. But if it's just like a regular get together and let's say, you know, it doesn't happen all that often. And then the classic, it's in every TV show, Seinfeld, like all of it. But when it comes time to pay, and there's usually somebody I feel like that wants to be like the generous one, like, hey, we don't get to see each other all that often. And then, like, I'll do it. So they put the card down. But then you go to put the card down. And then there's they throw the card back, or it's like they quickly hand it to the waitress or whatever. How do you go about doing that? Because sometimes I've been with friends who are like, split it, boom, no problem. Mm-hmm. But then it's like the other person's like insisting on getting it, and you're like, I don't know, man. Like, I don't want you to have to get all of this. Where do you come down on that?
Oh, I let him.
Thank you.
No, you know what you do?
A hearty thank you. Yeah.
Yeah, so what you do is my usual go-to is – so we try to both put them down, and they give you like the no, they give you like the credit card Heisman. Nope. So what you do is you do a half-hearted or like an in vain. You sure? Like you start to, you do the half push back. You sure?
Yeah.
And they go like, come on, please, Rich, I haven't seen.
Yeah.
And so then what you do, you take it back. You say, well, listen, I expect that. Thank you. Appreciate that. And then what you do is like, hey, if we get drinks afterward, they're on me.
Got it. Yeah. That's nice. And then you kind of know that's probably not happening anyway. And then you save yourself. Yeah,
but you put it out there. You were like, let me get you a beer or like an digestive.
Even though you paid, I'm actually more generous. Yeah. I'm the one offering the next thing.
An auxiliary treat.
That's not bad. That's not bad. Stiz, you got one?
Yeah, I do have one. This one's interesting.
Excellent. Okay, I love interesting.
I got roasted on Twitter. This was a few weeks ago, but
was that yesterday or the day before?
Every day I get roasted on Twitter.
So, yeah, same.
Tipping with haircuts. What is an appropriate tip when you get your haircut?
Well, it's crazy because what it costs you to get your haircut. Like talking like the three of us versus like my wife. My wife won't even tell me what she pays for haircuts because she knows I'd be like sick about it. Like it's like some of these women haircuts are insane.
Yeah,
so I would assume
those
you have
are
to
like $200.
So then you have
I know
to tip
what my wife's
crazy.
Is and it's horrifying.
Yeah, you're like, wait, what? Just let it grow then.
Yeah, women's haircut. So that is kind of how I went down this road is because my best friend is my barber. He's been cutting my hair for almost 20 years. Okay. And one of my friends posted on Twitter, like, if you don't give your barber $50 every time you get your hair cut, like,
$50?
Yes, right?
So, like, 50? Tripling or, like, yeah. Doubling the cost of the haircut?
Well, okay. So, this
That's
is
like
what
a 200%.
This is what I thought. Okay, so I got into a fight with this, not a fight, but just like a fun little battle.
I slugged him in the face once.
And I'm like, you're crazy. Like, I give my barber like $25. I go like every 2 weeks. I've been going forever. Like, blah, 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 blah. So a few weeks later, I go into my barber. I'm like, hey, like, I have this funny.
Were you giving $25 total or $25 on top of what it costs to get the haircut?
No, I was giving him like $25.
No. I think that makes way more sense. Because normally the price for, especially like a dude, like, hey, give me the dude regular.
Yeah,
like,
just
you go
like
in
a
there.
Little fade.
You're not in the chair very long.
Yeah, like 30 minutes.
Yeah.
So I said to my barber, I'm like, oh my God, these people are roasting me on Twitter saying like, if you don't give $50 and da-da-da-da-da. And my buddy said, Stiz, like, I didn't have the heart to tell you, but like a men's haircut's been $40 for like the past 3-4 years. He's like, you're my boy. I just, you know, it is what it is. Like, and I'm like, dude, what?
No,
I felt so embarrassed.
The place I go to, it even says it on the wall. It was 25 for the longest time. And then they kicked it up to like 27. Like, it's still...
That's still not that bad.
It's not at all that bad.
But I think around here, the haircuts are like $40 now, $50.
I always go to the same place I've been going now for, even having moved out of the town 2.5 years ago, I've been going now six and a half years to the same barber shop in Newton. The price was $25 until just after COVID when everything kind of went up. It's $30 now. Mm-hmm. And I always give my guy Rocco, who does a bang up every time.
Yep.
Shout out Rocco.
Yep.
Shout out Rocco. He's the best. You know, it's 30, so I give him like 10.
Yeah.
10's a good tip.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, yeah. You know, if I only have like 8 on me, I'll do that. Next time I'll make sure it's a 10 spot. Yeah. And we talk the whole That's time. Nice. And, you know, he's like, that just, you know, like something, it has to make sure, like, you can't just be like 5.
So I've done 5. And so what happened was the place I go to
is a quick trim. Right?
It is. It's quick. Well, I mean, I'm not in the chair long. And when it was $25, this place is cash only. And so you bring $30 and you're just like, give it to them. And they're always like, thanks. Then when they bumped it to 27, I'm like, well, I can't give the guy $3.
Yeah, no, you can't,
like,
give
I can't give
You know what you
got to
do. Now you got to make
gotta,
it like-
I got to bring like 50, and then I got to bring 50 in cash, and then I got to ask for change.
Yeah.
And then I'm like doing the math in my head. I'm like, I'm either asking for way more or way less. I'm like, such an idiot. I'm like, give me $1 back. He's like, are you sure? I can't just keep that. I'm like, I don't know, dude. Just figure it out. But yeah, it used to be a lot easier because you bring a 20 and a 10. You're like, hey, thanks for the haircut. And you walk out of there. And now I'm like, oh, okay.
All right. So here's a follow-up question. Yeah. What places, what establishments, businesses are still cash only more? Is it like ice cream shops, pizza parlors, or I feel like it is barbershops.
I think barbershops for sure. Like,
cornered the market on the cash only.
Yeah. Because I said the barbershop that I go to is right next to an ice cream place, and they let the cards fly there. It's credit cards all over the place. They have a little touchscreen on there. They're asking for tips like crazy on that. And you're like, all right, that's fine. But yeah, the barbershop, I'm trying to think if there's any other that are like, I know I have to get cash out before I go. Yeah, that might be it.
Yeah.
I hate when, like, every once in a while you'll run into a restaurant that
or
like halfway through your
day. And I'll be like, hands up.
Yeah. And then they're like, well, we do have an ATM over there. And the thing is like, it's like a $13
charge.
Yeah. And it's like,
worse than a strip club.
Yeah.
Someone told me.
Yeah.
Someone told me.
I don't know about that.
Like, how much money is actually in this thing? Like, who's even using this? Yeah. That's pretty good.
So right. $5 no go, $10 is the more acceptable.
I mean, like, where can somebody take, like, I always think, like, somebody should be able to take this tip and then in turn themselves, like, get 2 slices and a drink if they want, or go get a nice draft beer afterwards, or just something they can do, you know. $6 doesn't do much for you, but having a 10 in your pocket will put a little confidence in your
this one from the text line. My haircut is $60 and I do not tip.
Well, I you know what? I almost agree when it's $60.
So I kind of like, so there are certain things when all of a sudden you're jacking the price. Like, just over the last couple of years, like coffee, like just coffee.
Yes,
gone, like,
my coffee was $3.94 today. Medium ice at Dunk's was $3.94.
Would you just start making it at home? For
I know. He's been telling me this for 5 years.
I know, but there used to be always like the, just like keep the change kind of thing at like a coffee place. And you would just like put it in like the bucket. But then you're like, you're already charging me $5 a rip here. Like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I told you guys that I find the most galling of all. And, you know, Rich, we do everything we can shout out our friends at Idle Hands for a nice beer drop last week and everything.
Yes.
To support our local breweries and hashtag drink local. But you go to a brewery and you're like, I don't really want to pour. I'm just going to grab a couple 4-packs for home. Give me that new IPA.
Oh, yeah, that's
I'll take a lager. And they put them down.
20% or 25% tip? I'm like, on that?
Guy, you spun around and grabbed 8 beers and handed them to me. You took it, took away the thrill of me grabbing them off a shelf and bringing them up to the counter. Like, are we going to have to eventually start tipping, like, the gals and guys at Shaw's?
Yep, probably.
Or maybe the person.
They're doing more.
Check yourself out. Like, uh-oh.
Self-checkout, then there's, like, a little cup at the end. Like, for the one guy that has to watch you and who knows all the codes. Oh, yeah, what do you get there? Oranges? From the text line, tattoo shops.
Yeah, tattoo
still
shops.
Still cash only, cash, most of them.
Oh, wow.
That's a good one. You got to bring a lot of cash. You're getting like a big old tattoo. That's pretty good. All right, there you go. There's Can I Get a Ruling here on the Rich Keefe Show with Fitzy. We got Grab Bag coming up. But first, here is Stiz with What's Trending.
Now, here's What's Trending on WEEI.
All right, let's get you caught up one last time with what's trending right now on WEEI and WEEI.com. After they beat the Panthers 4-3 last night, the Bruins remained on the road. They are in Tampa Bay right now taking on the Lightning. Right now, the end of the second period. Tampa Bay is up 2-1 over your Boston Bruins. The Bolts have been on a roll during the second half of their season. They've gone 28-2 in their last 30 games. They've seized control of the first wild card spot in the Eastern Conference. Linus Ullmark is in the net for your Boston Bruins tonight. The Celtics have the night off tonight. Their road trip continues tomorrow. They will remain in Atlanta to take on the Hawks. The Hawks managed to crawl back from a 30-point deficit, beating the Celtics 120-118 on Monday night. The Celtics are hoping to get some get back tomorrow night at the State Farm Arena. Tip-off at 7:30. The Jordan Montgomery sweepstakes officially over. It was reported that the left-handed pitcher has agreed to a free agent deal with the Arizona Diamondbacks pending a physical. However, according to Jeff Passan of ESPN, the Sox have acquired right-hander Naoyuki Uesawa from the Rays. According to reports, the right-hander triggered an assignment clause and the Rays were close to making a trade. The Rays will receive cash considerations for Uesawa. I'm Stiz. That's what's trending now on WEEI and WEEI.com. More Rich Keefe Show, including Grab Bag, coming up.
Jones and Mego.
Do I care that they didn't sign Chase Young? I don't.
Did they call?
Did they check?
Yeah.
Were they even asking? Like, this is what I want to know about them now.
Are they asking on any free agents?
Are there any free agents?
WEEI, and tomorrow night, the Red Sox open up the 2024 season right here on WEEI, taking on the Seattle Mariners. First of four from Seattle. We'll have the pregame show 9:10 tomorrow night. First pitch at 10:10. But right now,
it's time for grab bag. It's time for grab bag.
Well, Fitzy, fresh off a big win over the Panthers last night, the Boston Bruins back in action again tonight, where they're getting set to start the third period, and they trail the Tampa Bay Lightning by a score of 2-1.
Well, may I say
yes.
That just like last night when I had confidence and faith in the Bees being on the road and being down as opposed to being up in the third,
yeah.
I feel good about them being able to tie this one. Now, I'm not sure if they're going to be able to get two goals within 5 minutes just like they did last night, but I feel okay. After, especially last night's win was a big boy win.
That was absolutely a big boy win. And last night it was Swayman. Tonight it's Linus Ullmark, who already through two periods has more saves tonight than Swayman had all of last night.
Wow. So wasn't it only like Swayman stopped 18 of 21, I think?
Yeah, that's right. And so far Ullmark stopped 19 of 21 through just two periods against Tampa Bay. Danton Heinen with the lone Bruins goal is 15th of the year. Pavel Zacha with the assist.
Kids love grab bag.
Oh, you mean as Celine Dion called him, Heino.
Grab bag!
BetMGM with their season totals, the over-unders for the upcoming football season as of right now.
Okay.
And they actually have the Patriots at 5.5. So the one we saw, I forget who is like Sporting AG or whatever. It was what other book came out with theirs. And they were at 4.5, which was tied with the Panthers for the lowest. But if you go to BetMGM, they have them at 5.5, which is still the tied for the second lowest in the NFL.
So I feel like that's probably going to be more commensurate to the other big domestic sports books like FanDuel, DraftKings,
yeah.
ESPN Bet, etc.
4.5 feels low. And like I said last night, if I had to bet it, it feels like a no bet, but if I had to bet it, I would take the under. 5.5, I have a lot more confidence in. Like looking at the opponents that they have this year, they win one more game than they did last year. Okay. 5, you still hit the under bet. Like I think that's way more likely.
Yeah, I feel like there's gonna be a lot of under action nationally and even regionally. If you say over, you know, like I said last night, I'll take the over on 4.5. 5.5 is a tough one.
And it really is. Were they going to win 6 games? Like, what are those teams? One of the Super Bowl?
All right, you primitive screwheads, listen up. This is my
grab bag.
Celtics Hawks tomorrow in Atlanta. The Celtics have been in Atlanta all week, which makes me think they'll probably lose to the Hawks tomorrow.
Come on. If they do, stop it.
I know, but Atlanta's like, it's a fun place for a lot of
they're a magic city.
Yeah.
Exactly. Oh, I thought they were going to be at the Varsity getting a delicious homemade French fries, an orange dreamsicle, and a patty melt.
What do you have?
Well done, Rich.
Yeah, I like that. I'm cultured.
Good on you, buddy.
I've been there. Yeah.
Oh, they're great.
Yeah.
Yep. But, you know, I got a lot of brushback from the two of us last night expressing a little concern in the Celtics blowing a 30-point lead because last night the Milwaukee Bucks had a 19-point lead against the Lake Show without LeBron James, and they blew that.
Yeah, it happens in the NBA, but like that was Joe Mazzulla's point in the postgame was like, 58 times a 20-point lead has been blown or whatever. You're like, why do you know that number? Why is that?
Just concentrate on calling a freaking timeout.
Were you looking up stats to talk about instead of calling timeouts? Like, I'm very concerned. But yeah, they have a chance just to smack around the Hawks tomorrow, get everybody feeling a little bit better about themselves. But we'll see. It is a weird thing because the Hawks are playing tonight in Atlanta. It's just very strange. So they played Monday night in Atlanta. Then neither of them played last night. Hawks are hosting the Trailblazers right now. And then they play each other again tomorrow in Atlanta. So there you go. They're up 109-96.
Hawks are
against, well, Portland. Portland stinks. Yeah, Portland.
It's raining.
Grab bag.
How about Steve Belichick, the defensive coordinator for the University of Washington this upcoming season? They were having like a little chat, and he got to admit he had a pretty good burn on his dad.
We definitely have similarities. I got a job, and he doesn't.
Wow.
He knows that. But yeah, I mean, I look up to my dad. He's a mentor to me, but I'm myself. And yeah, like PC said, excited to get out on the field and work with these guys and work with the kids and recruit kids. And it's kind of just going to be myself. I'm not going to.
Well, I got to tell you, you can take the Belichick out of New England, but you can't take the Belichick out of Belichick, man.
Oh, my God. It's a good line, good dry line, something like that his dad would say. The cadence and the voice is just so similar. How long do you think Steve Belichick is going to be a college D coordinator for?
2 years. Two seasons, maybe.
Yeah. And then maybe back to the NFL or, I don't know. It's interesting. I mean, those are highly paid jobs.
Yeah, I know. But what if things don't go for Mayo? Would they consider
no.
you?
Okay. No. Right. Okay. At that point, you got to go like what I kind of wanted originally. Somebody that has never even shook the man's hand. I need somebody so far away from the Belichick tree. Because if Mayo does fail, good Lord, that coaching tree, you could light a match to it. Just everybody move on. So, yeah, they'd have to do something a little bit different.
My calculations are correct. When this baby hits 88 miles per hour, you're going to see some serious
grab bag.
John Calipari is going to return to the University of Kentucky next year. The Wildcats athletic director confirmed today. Coach Cal is a bit of a rough patch here recently. He's still recruiting. He's still bringing in five-star guys, you know, one-and-done lottery picks. But they got bounced by Oakland this year. Really the one major upset in the whole tournament, just about.
What was the dude's name? Golke?
Yeah, couldn't miss. He was a D2 transfer.
Golke.
Golke had, didn't he have, was it more made baskets than dribbles? Was that the number? Something crazy. He didn't dribble. He's like Clay Thompson back in the day.
Magic number was 8. He attempted 8 non-3-pointers.
8 non-3s, but he also never put the ball on the ground. It was just like catch and shoot, catch and shoot, catch and shoot. And, yeah, so they lose. And if you heard any of Calipari after that game, he was like, yeah, we made a lot of errors, and, you know, it was all the freshmen. So, like, okay. You've also been coaching those freshmen for not 8 months or whatever. Like, you'd think you're the 3 seed. You'd think you guys would be a little bit better off. Was it 3 years ago or 4 years ago they were the 2 seed when they lost to St. Peter's? The things aren't going
great.
Four
out of five bumps and they miss it. Like, maybe he just don't got it anymore. Maybe it's time for a new voice in the room.
He may not have it. He may not have it.
You are part of the Rebel Alliance and a
grab bag.
Take it away.
Well, speaking of the NCAA, Charlie Baker, who's the president, is trying to ban all college prop bets.
I like that.
It's banned in a bunch of states, right? Like, you couldn't bet on, for example, this is just a complete hypothetical I have. You couldn't bet Bo Nix over touchdowns in Massachusetts, but if you happen to have a Vegas weekend with your buddies, you could bet over Bo Nix touchdowns. You're allowed to do that there.
Yeah, I feel like that. Like, here's what it is, you know, and it's part of the national discourse now, just the integration of sports at the collegiate and the professional level and how easy it is to gamble on them, whether you're gambling your own sport, which you shouldn't do, or you're supposed to be forbidden from doing, and gambling on other sports. And I feel like the college kids who may not have NIL deals or who may not make it to the pros but can figure like, hey, if I just do this, if like full well known this guy was sick or this guy's going to have a great matchup, that's going to lead to some of these guys maybe stepping out and doing this. You just ban it. Just don't give anyone a chance. It's going to suck for some people. I agree with Baker. I think this is one of the first times we can stand in unanimity with a decision made by the NCAA.
Yeah, it kind of makes the most sense. Like, there are certain times, like, as a fan, you'd be like, oh, let me bet, like, national championship game, not just on the spread and the over-under, but I also want to, you know, throw in a J.J. McCarthy prop or something like that. But I agree. Like, you see the Jontay Porter situation going on with the Raptors, and, you know, he's a low, you know, he's not highly paid for an NBA player, but he's a professional player, and he's in it, and he's probably not the only one. And then you get into college where there's just so many thousands of athletes. And Iowa and Iowa State both had a thing last year where they were like cracking down on that. And I don't know if it was, I don't think it was player props, but I think it was just weird kind of thing and concerns about gambling. So yeah, it probably is the smartest thing to do.
Do you know the Klingon proverb that tells us
grab bag
is a dish that is best served cold?
How about, speaking of money and college players, Caitlin Clark, the stud at Iowa, has been offered $5 million by Ice Cube to participate in the Big Three.
Oof. That is some nice. That's
$5 million?
You know, one of the most popular phrases tossed around in regards to money these days, Rich, is generational wealth.
$5 million. Well, in this economy, maybe not. You get a haircut and a cup of coffee.
Yeah, that's not including the tip.
Taxes, tips. Yeah. It's still good. It's a good chunk of change, though. I'll give you
that. It's a nice chunk of change.
It's a ton of
hands. Can't get anything in the seaport for less.
But. No, you can't.
Yeah. Now, would this allow for her to still play in the WNBA?
I think she can. I think so. I don't see why not.
So why wouldn't she say yes?
Take $5 million and play in your little three-on-three tournament with a bunch of old guys. You know what? Kenyon Martin, former number one overall pick. Kenyon Martin, what he had to say about it?
What?
She wouldn't score a single point. I was like, I don't know, man. Like, she shoots from like half court. I don't think she's not looking to, like, post up Rasheed Wallace, but she could probably step back and hit some shots, I would think.
Old Kenyon Martin said that?
Yep. Yeah, she wouldn't score a point.
Kmart, wow.
Kmart, yep.
You're going to need a bigger grab bag.
When we were talking about Bill Belichick earlier in the show, Fitz, before you joined, we're talking about Bill Belichick and what his potential options might be for TV. Mm-hmm. Next year, so the ESPN wants him, but he doesn't really want to do a studio show. But the main headline of the story in The Athletic was more about Jason Kelce, and it looks like everybody wants Jason Kelce on there.
Understandably so.
Yeah, whether it's Amazon, CBS, Peacock, because every network and every streaming platform has football in some capacity going forward. Mm-hmm. So they all want Jason Kelce. The biggest rumor is he might knock Robert Griffin III out of the Monday Night Football pregame lineup.
I don't feel like that's his best. I don't watch the Monday Night Football. Like, if you're going to tell me they're going to use him on ESPN Sunday NFL Countdown and on Monday Night Football, I might see him. I'd rather see him on either a network pregame show or, like, give him the bag and make him the dude on Amazon. Like, clean that set up.
Yeah,
like,
give a reason to watch the Amazon one.
Goodbye, yeah. Richard Sherman. Goodbye, Whitworth. Make it like Fitzpatrick, Carissa Thompson, if she's still hosting. And I would just make Jason Kelce a centerpiece because he's great.
Yeah, he is.
He has so much personality.
Yeah, he does. And he also kind of, he's both where I think he's so charismatic. He has his podcast, so he's got sort of all that going for him. But he's also a good player, right? Like, sometimes you have one or the other. It's like, well, that guy wasn't a great player, but he's pretty good on the air. And then this guy's like, yeah, he's not really good on the air, but he was a great player. Like, Kelce has both. Like, Kelce's probably, he's going to be a Hall of Famer, and yep. I think he's going to be really, really good at it.
And I heard Saquon.
Go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was going to say Saquon. I heard Saquon Barkley is trying to talk him out of retirement as he's fielding this host of offers to join TV shows.
Yeah, I mean, Barkley might have a chance. I don't know if I'm going to believe that Kelce's officially retired until it's like week one and he's sitting doing TV.
Swing. There's a line drive left center field. Deep back by the wall. And it is.
Grab bag.
Sweet 16 action gets going tomorrow night, Fitzy, in right here at the TD Garden. The UConn Huskies are going to be in action, part of a doubleheader over at the Garden tomorrow.
I know. When's the last time that the tournament actually made their way to the Garden? Like,
good question.
I love the idea of being able to pay $500 to watch my brackets go up in flames in real time.
Yep. Oh, exactly. Yeah, but the place is just going to be just full of UConn Husky fans. That's all it's going to be. They take on San Diego State. I have a feeling they may not travel quite as far.
No. Wait, wasn't that the final last year?
Did they beat San Diego State in the final? That's how it tells you how much I keep up with it. Yeah,
I'm pretty sure that UConn beat San Diego State in the NCAA men's final last year.
There you go. So a little rematch.
And anyone who's watching Twitch right now could also see my 11-year-old has entered the frame and is attempting to floss.
It's an all right floss. It's a half-hearted floss. Oh, there he goes. Now he's hitting his full rhythm.
Here, Thomas, do you want to give us a live grab bag? Just say grab bag. Ready? Go.
Grab bag.
All right, save that one, Stiz. That's an updated grab bag right there. Very good. I do appreciate the PlayStation sweatshirt. Hopefully you got that with the system and not just, you know, to support Sony. But very good.
The hills fill my heart with the sound of me.
Grab bag.
In the theaters this weekend, Fitzy, Godzilla X Kong, The New Empire. Where are you on that?
When I first saw the trailer and I saw like a yellow, obviously CGI'd mechanized glove forming on the arm of a creature, I thought, oh, wow, this must be a new Transformers movie.
He's got a Thanos glove.
What are we doing?
I also don't know how to say it. Is it Godzilla X Kong? Like, what's the X?
Or is it Times Kong? Like they're
Times Kong.
Because I feel like they team up, so it's kind of like more mashup
they're
this
buds.
Time than
yeah.
it is like okay. versus.
Yeah, maybe they're buds. That could definitely be the case.
I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody. Instead of a
grab bag.
Which is what I am.
All right, we'll end on this one, Fitzy, as this was making the rounds. This is from an old interview, but it was making the rounds on the internet yesterday, and it was a sit-down with the great Harrison Ford. And this is hilarious, too, because you and I are Star Wars dorks. We are super into Star Wars, all the different discussion about it, all the different, like, oh, did you see this scene and that scene? Like, what does it mean? Is it tied together, or are they all this crap? And so here was a sit-down with Harrison Ford about one of the big questions surrounding Han Solo and really just Star Wars in general.
Did you shoot Greedo first, or did Greedo shoot you first?
I don't care.
Might be one of the greatest junket replies of all time. Can we hear it again?
I don't care.
All right. I don't care. But I love the guy asking too. He's like, we're going to get to the bottom of this. Like, we're going to get.
What do you think, Harris? What do you think, Han Solo?
He should know. He read the script.
I don't care.
I don't care.
Oh, I love the. You know, I just want, like, again, back to generational wealth. We may not all ever get there by hitting Mega Millions or, you know, getting seafood towers handed to us when we host morning programs on EEI. But to be able to just have that, like, don't give an F energy like that, like, that's just
so
where I want to be one day.
He definitely doesn't. Harrison, there's the great Harrison Ford. So there you go. There's grab bag for tonight. We'll wrap up the program with our final thoughts coming up next.
From the Rubenstein Law Studios, 1-800-BOS-LEGAL. This is WEEI.
Gate City Casino is your new casino, now closer to home. Located in Nashua, New Hampshire, Gate City Casino features table games, poker, electronic craps and roulette, plus over 500 gaming machines, including all of your favorite big casino titles. Why sit in traffic when Gate City Casino is just around the corner? Gate City Casino, located at Exit 4, Route 3 in Nashua, New Hampshire.
The IRS is the most powerful collection agency on Earth, and if you owe back taxes, the news isn't good. The IRS is raising the interest rate it charges on unpaid taxes, and further rate hikes are expected. Most people don't know it, but the IRS adds interest charges to your tax debts daily. So if you owe the IRS today, you'll owe even more tomorrow. And it doesn't stop until you get right with the IRS. The good news is getting right can start with one phone call to Optima Tax Relief, America's number one tax relief firm. Optima's tax professionals specialize in the Fresh Start Initiative, a powerful IRS program that can save you thousands if you qualify. In fact, the experts at Optima have resolved over $1 billion in tax debt for their clients. Call now for a free consultation.
Call 800-354-2840. 800-354-2840. 800-354-2840.
Optima Tax Relief.
Some restrictions apply. For complete details, please visit OptimaTaxRelief.com.
33 great years.
Hi, Kimberly Dyer from Cromwell Chevrolet, and it's our 33rd year in business. Wow. And we want it to be our best year yet for us and especially you.
We've got plenty of Chevys in stock and on the way. Crossovers, SUVs, Silverados, and used vehicles too. And we're celebrating 33 years with our best prices ever.
We shop the competition daily, like we always have, to guarantee you our best price possible every day.
Our best price possible on every Chevy in stock every day.
We want this to be our best year yet. Especially for you.
Carmel Chevrolet, located right off Route 495, exit 103A in Lawrence.
For your best Chevy deal, find us fast at shopuslast.com.
We're celebrating 33 years with our best prices ever.
It's our 33rd year in business. Wow.
Hi, Charlie Dyer, and thanks for 33 great years, and this will be our best yet.
33 great years, and the best is yet to come.
Shop Us Last, you'll love us.
When it comes to getting the guaranteed lowest price on Toyo tires, there's only one place to go. Town Fair Tire. And when it comes to getting more free services for life than anywhere else on Toyo tires, there's only one place to go. Town Fair Tire. So when you're in the market for a new set of Toyo tires, there's only one place to go. Because nobody beats a Town Fair Tire deal. Absolutely nobody.
Name brands at discount prices. Town Fair.
We're Right Window in Woburn. Our competitors think we're in Woburn. That's because they're not from around here. One's off doing the nation. The other's trying to conquer the world. Right Window, all we care about is doing your house. Because we're around your corner and up your block, and we'd like it to look nice, too. But does being a local replacement window company really matter? Well, yeah, it does. Like, we're going off to Peabody? They're looking around for Peabody. We have customers over in Natick. They're driving around looking for Natick. And when we go to Scituate, I can't even tell you where they think they're going. Not allowed to say it on the radio. So yes, Right Window. If you want Energy Star windows professionally in...
Available feature. Intelligent 4x4 cannot prevent collisions or provide enhanced traction in all conditions. Always monitor traffic and weather conditions.
If you missed any of our Patriots Monday and Friday interviews, go back and listen on the podcast anytime. Just subscribe to The Rich Keefe Show on the Odyssey app or wherever you find your podcasts.
Now, more of The Rich Keefe Show
on WEEI.
Back here on the Rich Keefe Show with Fitzy, WEEI. Red Sox open up the regular season tomorrow night, taking on the Seattle Mariners. We'll have the pregame coverage right here at 9:10 tomorrow night. First pitch at 10:10. Brian Baio on the mound. Going into the season, taking a look at Spotrac's list of total payroll for the 2024 season. So this includes the 26 man, payroll, injured reserve, retained, all that stuff. It's all added up. Let's play a quick game of Guess Them Rankings.
Oh, I love Guess Them
Rankings. You love Guess Them Rankings. Where do the Red Sox, as of today, sit in Major League Baseball's total payroll rankings?
This is uninformed and random as can be. I'm going to go with 14th out of 30.
Ooh, boy, that is real close. They are 12th. They are 12th in Major League Baseball. They are sandwiched just behind the St. Louis Cardinals and just ahead of the Los Angeles Angels. They're sitting there total prize package of $162 million. There are nine teams at over $200 million and just the one over $300. That would be...
the Dodgers?
No, the Mets.
The Metropolitans are still...
the Dodgers have the ninth highest payroll. The Dodgers kind of spend it wise. Now, I don't know if that includes the new Will Smith deal. Not that Will Smith. They just signed a big contract to Will Smith. That was today. So I don't know if that's included in this. But the top five are Mets, Yankees, Astros, Phillies, Braves. Then it goes Blue Jays, Rangers, Cubs, Dodgers, Giants. And then the next tier of five, the Red Sox are involved in. So it's like... 12th. On the one hand, you're like, it feels like it's a lot lower than it is, but there are some teams that just don't spend money at all. Like, there are the bottom 10 teams are all under $100 million. The Oakland A's have their payroll is under $50 million.
K Can I place a I guess I could probably do it in a sports book, but can I buy into the idea that the A's won't have the worst record? They might have the second or the third worst record. I don't think they're gonna have the worst record this year.
Really? Yeah, you could probably.
I think it might be the Rockies.
Oh, so you might? Yeah,
super might, not good.
No, they stink. That's a bad roster, and they're right in the middle of the pack. They have the 16th highest payroll somehow. Holy smokes!
Who the hell? Name a Rocky.
Do they still have? I feel like Charlie Blackman's been on that team for 100 years. That's a good question. I don't know, there's not a lot of Rockies. That's a bad outfit out there.
That's a rough take.
But it seems like the
right area.
Oh yeah, sure. Nice ballpark. You can smash a lot of home runs out there. But I feel like the Red Sox at 12th, the problem is it feels like it's going the other way. It feels like at some point, you're talking about like the trade deadline. Oh, Kenley Jansen and Chris Martin are gone. It's like, who'd you bring in? Oh, prospects. Prospects that don't even, you don't have to pay. Like just like really cheap prospects. So that part's concerning.
Can I leave you with this little nugget?
Yes, please.
On the way out the door, circling back to our draft talk from earlier. The belief is that quarterback J.J. McCarthy had a, quote, better pro day compared to quarterback Jaden Daniels per at Tony Pauline.
Oh.
That is a verified reporting account. Pauline adds that a few on hand at LSU's pro day believe, and now this momentum is building, the Commanders will end up taking J.J. McCarthy over Daniels. We may have us.
Because the pro day?
No, just like
for
McCarthy to go second overall to the Commanders.
I would take Jaden Daniels. I know his elbow is very strange looking. I'd have to get a nice little peek at that again. But
another sports doctor weighed in. Doc Flynn weighed in and said that has to be either a weird angle or a shutter anomaly because there's no chance a human elbow can exist in that capacity.
Yeah, what image is that? That's so bizarre. But obviously he's chucking the ball 70 yards today, so I don't think it's holding him back. But yeah, that's a real possibility with still 28 days, 22 hours, 5 minutes, and 50 seconds until the NFL draft that J.J. McCarthy might go 2. That's crazy. And then now the Patriots don't have a choice between Drake May and Jaden Daniels. Now they really better not trade out. It's like now you get one of those guys. Like those are... You gotta like at least one of them if you're Elliot Wolf and Gerard Mayo.
You would think, all but right. You never know.
Fitzy, great stuff this week. You 3 straight days, so take some time off. Take all the time you need. And
I'll be back next Monday, friend.
All right, we'll talk to you on Monday. Stiz and I, no, Braverman's in for the show tomorrow with Hart, but then Stiz and I have the pregame at 9:10, followed by Red Sox baseball in the season opener. So. Thanks, everybody, for listening tonight. Have a great rest of your Wednesday night. We'll talk to you tomorrow at 6.
There's only one left thing to say.
Honey, it's our favorite leaf filter trusted pro, Matt. Matt, come in.
Hi, Mrs. Sparks. You wanted me to stop by? Is everything okay with your leaf filter gutter protection system?
Okay. Of course, silly. We wanted you to stop by for dinner as our way of thanking you.
Yes, to thank you for that free gutter inspection, the free estimate, and what was the other thing?
That lifetime guarantee.
Well, Mr. and Mrs. Sparks, those are just Leaf Filter's policies. Everyone who calls Leaf Filter gets a trusted pro to come out for a free gutter inspection and estimate. And every Leaf Filter installation comes with a lifetime guarantee.
So it's not just us?
No, sir. We don't want anyone to worry about clogged gutters ever again.
You mean everyone gets this level of service?
Everyone. They just need to visit leaffilter.com/market to schedule their free inspection.
Okay, but you must be starving. You work so hard.
Ready to love your gutter protection as much as we do? Visit leaffilter.com/market and get up to 30% off today.
See representative for warranty details. Promotion is 20% off plus a 10% senior or military discount. One discount per household.
Hey, it's Fourier. As we gear up for our air conditioning season, beat the rush by contacting McFarland Energy today to upgrade your AC system. Thinking about ductless for that 3-season room? They've got you covered. And mention WEEI to save $500 on any AC install. North Shore, Greater Boston, to the Cape. Homeowners, trust McFarland for top-notch home heating oil delivery and HVAC services. Learn more at McFarlandEnergy.com and be sure to ask about BioHeat, a much cleaner alternative. Are you